Shall I start, sir?
एक मिनट मैडम, डॉक्टर प्रीति,
यस सर।
सो हाउ मच टाइम इज अलॉटेड टू मी? 20 मिनट्स, 50 मिनट्स?
सर, इट्स अप टू यू।
नो
नो
नो नो
टाइम,
वट इज
नो
योर
टाइम
शेड्यूल?
अभी।
वट इज योर शेड्यूल? डिसाइडेड, आई विल गो विद दिस।
30, 35, 40 minutes,
ओके
व्हाटएवर
ओके
यू,
ओके
इट्स अप टू यू।
ओके थैंक
थैंक्स।
यू। शैल आई स्टार्ट और बैक टू वेट?
डॉक्टर सुनील, डॉक्टर भुवन हैज जॉइंड।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर, इट इज डॉक्टर सुनील।
हाउ आर यू डॉक्टर सुनील?
सर आई एम फाइन सर,
ठीक है,
एब्सोल्युटली फाइन सर।
नाइस
थैंक यू
टू मीट
वेरी
यू ऑन
मच
दिस
सर, यू आर
प्लेटफॉर्म।
या थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू वेरी मच सर, यू आर गिविंग द चांस टू अस सर। थैंक यू सर,
यू थैंक डॉक्टर प्रीति।
थैंक यू डॉक्टर प्रीति इज ऑल्सो ऑलवेज थैंकफुल। यस
He's taking examination on short notice, huh?
yeah, sir. This is a very short notice. You have accepted our invitation, which is very, this is, I'm highly thankful to you, sir.
You are doing, you people are doing good job, so we should also assist and support. And this is the issue.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank
I think we should start. It's live now.
Yeah, sir. Yeah. Yes, madam.
A very good afternoon to all. I, Preeti Tagore, President, PRISL Foundation, along with Dr. Bhuvan Chandra, Principal, Ideal Institute of Pharmacy, Vada, Palghar, Maharashtra, and Dr. Sunil Singh, Principal, Ideal Institute of Pharmacy, Vada, Palghar, Maharashtra, as a co-convener, we invite you, all the delegates, our chief guests, in an international webinar on ICT tools, which is a need of an hour. It's my honor and privilege to cordially invite our esteemed chief guest, Professor Shailen Saraf. So,
thank you.
President, Pharmacy Council of India, Professor Pandit Ravi Shankar, Shukla University, Raipur. I would like to welcome our resource person, Dr. Prasun Sharma, researchers, Etwas Loran University, Hungary. I would like to welcome Dr. Shubham Dubey. He is a lecturer in Computer Science Department, Debrecen University. I would like to welcome Honorable Abhishek Jain, Chairman, Ideal Foundation, Vada, Palghar, Maharashtra. I would like to welcome all esteemed directors, principals, faculties, researchers, and my dear students. Let me tell you why we choose the theme ICT tools. So, since we know that a smart technology is the main technology that is widely being used in every begins life, and everyone knows and up to date with that. ICT is an information communication technology which is very precise, has become a driving force behind economic and growth and development tool as well. In this toughest COVID-19 pandemic crisis, this ICT tool has proven to be in each and every sector. So it's really a time that we are influenced our life in the field of education, healthcare, business. Even this platform has been utilized by the, you know, politicians' promotional activity also. So going to extra miles, it's really a need. This technology, and we need to upgrade ourselves, since we have proved that we are, you know, we are ourselves expert in the jurisprudence. We are no engineering. We know everything. But the ICT tools nowadays, it's really needed to us to learn each and every factors. So In the meanwhile, we need to collaborate ourselves with engineering and with the technology as well, so that we can profound and we can found ourselves perfect. So I would like to brief a little bit about Prizl Foundation. It's highly dedicated and efficiently working in pharmaceutical education sector. Our main motto is to aware society and promote excellency in the field. In 2019, we have also interviewed in AICT Swayam MOOCs learning program, as also we are working and promoting e-learning concept in through our society. Let me take privilege to brief Ideal Institute of Technology, Ideal Institute of Pharmacy, which is running under the visionary leadership of Honorable Abhishek Jain Ji, who is the continuously promoting education system. And in this pandemic, he had gives his hospital complete medical staff for COVID-19. With this word, I would like to welcome our chief guest.
Priti, shall I start?
Just, sir. I don't know what happened. I would like to welcome our chief guest in an international webinar, Honorable Professor Dr. Shailen Sarap, Sir, Vice President, Pharmacy Council of India, and just accept our bouquet, which we have taken as we are connected virtually. So nature is our treasurer, helps to save it, virtual bouquet. So we start this initiative as well. Let me brief about, it's honor to me that Professor Shailen Sarap, sir, he is a leading scientist and well-known academician in the field of pharmaceutical sciences. He holds the position of Director, University Institute of Pharmacy, and Dean, Faculty of Technology, Pandit Ravishankar Shukla University, Raipur. He is also a chairman, Board of Studies of the University. Professor Shailen Sarap, sir, he is an alumni of Department of Pharmaceutical Sciences, Dr. Hari Singh Gaur University, Sagar. He has more than 27 years of experience in research academics. He has more than 250 publications to his credits in reputed international and national journal. Has citation more than 2,354. Sir is active associated with various national international accreditation like UGC, AICT, NEC, NBA, and it's really, sir, we have an honor to have sir with us. Sir has represented as a national delegate in a study group constituted by Pharmacy Council of India to visit UK and participated in international conferences as a keynote speaker at Singapore, Switzerland, UAE. He is a delegate member of various international bodies. Even it's really that we have honor to have sir. Welcome you once again, sir.
Thank you.
It's very concise brief. You have a 35-40 page, so I just concise.
So thank you, Dr. Priti. So I believe your chairman of Ideal Group is also there. So Honorable Chairman of Ideal Group of Institutions, the principals, Dr. Singh and Dr. Bhuvan. the patron of this organize this webinar, and president of PRISL, very active young leader, Dr. Preeti. The delegates from Hungary and other countries, Dr. Jain, Dr. I believe Subham Dubey and Prashant Sharma. Prashant Sharma. So it's really great to see all of you on this platform. And even on Sundays, you are spending your time for the betterment of profession. You deserve compliments. And most important, the delegates, teachers, and dear budding pharmacist and students, I cannot tell you how much disappointed I am with the this disturbance due to pandemic during your academic session. But at the same time, I cannot also tell you how much proud I am on all of you for your seamless transition from merely classroom teacher teaching to classroom student and teacher to international teacher and learner. With no time, you have adopted this technology, and that is one of the example, and it shows the desire and your competence to adopt the new technologies. The topic is well taken, and though it is very little time has been given to me, less than 24 hours, so I'm acquainted with all that because we are examining students for full length and sometimes spontaneous and surprise test also. So this time I'm giving my surprise test. But since this topic is very near to my heart, so I'll try to justify my observation about the importance of this topic. And for this, we have to understand what is the present circumstance of this condition. We are living in a totally changed world. And this is not the end. This is just end of beginning. Because we have to learn to live with all such things in times to come. There was no prediction, there was no forecasting, no alarm, no warning, nothing. It means we were not prepared. So this also given us a thought process to we have to prepare the graduates so that they are prepared for unprepared and such type of pandemics. Before that, we were talking a lot about the industry 4.0. This I am just sensitizing for last, I think, a decade. We have to prepare ourselves for the industrial 4.0. And it's not necessary, even if you're not preparing for the industrial 4.0, and if you're not transforming yourself from academia 3.0 to 4.0, you will automatically transform. But when there is a time, you should always try to drive the profession from the front. You should not be driven by the circumstances. That's why I was just discussing with all my peers and friends to prepare yourself for the industry 4.0. And one more important observation I can give, because the first industrial revolution was happened in 1784 when the steam power was invented. And it takes around 100 years for the next industrial revolution. It was around, 1870, and the first was in 1760. It takes 100 years when the electricity was invented, electric power was invented, and the production line was introduced. Then it takes around 60 hours for the third industrial revolution. And now it takes less than 40 years time. It means that the gap of different industrial revolution is narrowing down. It means there is a lot of technology is coming into the industry. That's why there is a lot of changes in the society. We are talking about the Internet of Things at present. We are talking about artificial intelligence, but we don't know at what time there must be 100% application of quantum computing. So we have to keep our eyes open. And according to these four industrial revolutions, there were four academic and education revolution as well. The first education revolution was just having the knowledge, just having one degree is sufficient to get the knowledge, at the same time respect and your livelihood, and survive with respect in the profession. That was one degree is enough. Then came the second education revolution, where refreshing of your knowledge was the concept. And when it was the third industrial revolution, was electronics was introduced. So that was Nissan's necessity at that time. You have to acquire additional degree. Then only you will be able to survive. And as far as the McKinsey survey is concerned, at present, more than 70% of staff, which is on board, is not appropriately electronically trained. This was the story of education paradigm 4.0. Now we are living in education paradigm 4.0. And this industry 4.0 came into our life very silently. And as it was predicted by Stephen Hawking, so this is the amalgamation of physical sciences, biological sciences, and computer sciences, information technology as well. So this is the typical different type of industrial revolution. And if we have to survive in this particular evolution, industrial environment, so we have to learn the fourth paradigm shift of education 4.0. And what is the 4.0? This is, you have to learn the concept of learning, refreshing, relearning. But most important, in case of the fourth education revolution, you have to learn an additional skill that is known as unlearning. What you have learned earlier, you have to configure, you have to format your computer, you are learning, and you have to propose yourself for the relearning. Then only you will be able to survive in the society. What is the society as present? Though this is the Indian cultural, because the concept, this is, they always talk about the mind over matter. But this is time when we are living in a 4.0 industrial revolution, we are always talking about ideas and IPR. There are big battles being fought between two companies and settled in trillions of dollars and having no physical value. So when we have to survive in the industry 4.0, so we have to understand this is time of mind over matter. So what is the requirement for mind over matter is there is a need to have ideation. As I have mentioned, there was no prediction, no warning, no alarm from any corner. It means we are not putting our head for the forecasting of our own profession. So this is right time. So we have to sit down for some time and we have to evolve a mechanism and we have to give lot of time for the method of ideation, because as far as Albert Einstein said, the highest form of research is ideation. And in our teaching, we can say Indian system of education, there's a very little component is given for the ideation. Though we always claim the information with the academic institution and data available to the academic institution is the wealth. But where this wealth does go? So we have to understand. So there is a concept of self-learning and what is required, what is this self-learning? So you have to throw the students in a room, ideation room, where all the data and information is provided. What you have to do as a teacher, you have to ensure that they are not paralyzed with those informations. You have to provide them tools and techniques to understand the knowledge and analyze the data. Then only they will be able to come out with the idea. Because what is happening in our country, we have always the reluctance. We have always inertia for the change. We were talking a lot about the inclusion of electronic medium for the teaching and learning, but there was inertia, there was reluctance. But when time came, we have transformed overnight. It means there is a scope. So now onward, we have to be proactive and we have to learn a lot of things in advance. And if we talk about this healthcare expectations are concerned, what is happening in the academic industry, in the pharmaceutical industry? So there is a lot of adoption of artificial intelligence by the pharma and biotech industry. At the same time, we are expanding the horizons for the chemical space for drug discovery. Nobody is talking about the fresh researches, but we are sharing the information. We are sharing the information with other platforms, and we are coming out with candidate as far as chemical discovery of the drug is concerned. And people have already started working on targeting of RNA with the small molecules. And new antibody discovery is having an entirely different approach that is integrated with machine learning.
And as far as the skinning is concerned, there are a lot of drugs which are not off patented and which are having some solubility and stabilization problem. So we are stabilizing those drugs through phenotyping skinning and xenotyping skinning also. At the same time, the biggest concept is coming on organ on chip. At the same time, this is time for the bioprinting. And I am talking about the new origins of pharmaceutical profession and what is our role in years to come. So we have to reinvent ourselves because we are just patting our back with the success in the industrial pharmacy. But time is gone. If you are not able to translate your academic knowledge into financial gain, you will be lost. What we are doing, just manufacturing, we are catering the needs of the world, that is not sufficient. It means we have to think about innovation and inventions and innovations. And for that, there is a need to have a proper ecosystem where we have to learn to work in collaboration as a team.
Hello, sir. Please unmute.
I think you are anyway.
Okay.
So, if you want to survive in this artificial intelligence era, so you have to develop the super intelligence. Otherwise, you will be lost. At the same time, you have to devote a lot of time for the ideation and for the survival of with the profession. At the same time, if you talk about what is the expectation in the society. So we always think about the production of drug, but now we are focusing a little bit about the patient care as well. But the need of the hour is we have to think about industry also. And what is the role of the industry in years to come? Even pharmaceutical industry will not stand alone in isolation. They will be in coordination with other things. Because as far as the United Nations is concerned, so they have identified some certain areas for the scientists to give these solutions. And one of them is healthcare is the rapid point to point of care system so that each and everyone is covered. When healthcare systems, all healthcare professionals are working on such areas, we are not focusing on that. At the same time, when we are talking about small things, because I have mentioned we are happy with the development in the field of production of new pharmaceutical formulations, but the real heroes in this particular pandemic is three-layer simple masks and sanitizers, and they are not pharmaceutical products. So while we are focusing on big things, we have to focus on small things as well, and we have to ensure that pharmacists are playing their role in all such areas. And the foremost requirement as far as these sustained development growth parameters were fixed by United Nations is they want a membrane-free filter for the potable water. So we have to think about such things also. If we talk about the agriculture, if we talk about the production of herbal medicines, so more than 60% losses during the harvesting. So they are the areas, and at the same time, United Nations is also talking about different forms of energy and renewable energy. And what is the role models operating throughout the world as far as pharmacy is concerned? So in US alone, the topmost second company of healthcare insurance is coordinating with the retail supply chain. So again, there is a total change in the model of this supplying of the drug. We are still thinking about and opposing the internet pharmacy, all that. So we have to face the challenges in this area also, because retail chain and health insurance, they are coming together. As far as McKinsey is concerned, they are identifying India as a hub for the medical tourism. At the same time, they are identifying India as an important sector where the healthcare insurance is growing like anything. So if we have to utilize this potential, so we have to educate ourselves and we have to educate our students as well. And as far as the policy forms is concerned, so there is a need to have very proactive policies. Because I can give you an example. A few years back, the whole world was looking at India as far as the clinical science is concerned. And they had with different reasons to choose this particular land for clinical trials because we have a great diversity. At the same time, we have the phenotype and genotype, both the systems are relevant in country. But due to the non-cooperational attitude of the regulatory system, this is gone from this country. We lost the opportunity. And I can quote you, I can give you an exact example. More than 30%, 30 clinical trials are being conducted in the US alone. They are comprising less than 5% of the world population. 30% clinical trials are being done in the US. And what is the system there in the US? The patients are going to court of law. They are taking the intervention of the court of law. They are requesting to have to be included in the clinical trials because they are aware that whatever drugs are coming, they are better research drug. But in the India, we have different mindset. So we lost this opportunity. Again, we have to think and we have to create this environment so that this particular clinical trials market again grow in this particular country. And at the same time, we are talking very high about the generics. But there's a case of hypocrisy also. When we are supplying the 50% of drugs to UK and more than 30% generic needs to US, but at the same time, we have a big population which is not having the reach to the pharmaceuticals. So when we are thinking about the international needs, we have to just focus about old needs as well. And one more important thing, what is happening is there is a data and there is need to have a real time data. And this is a real world data. This data will help to provide better healthcare systems in years to come. So India can play a big role in this area also, because again, we have a lot of diversity as far as phenotype and genotypic patients are concerned. So this lot of work has to be done. And what is the role of the academia? What is the role really in this particular digital era? Because if we are talking about this academia and ICT and all that, so PowerPoint was the latest invention in ICT 30 years back. If you are considering PowerPoint presentation as a still IC tool, you just forget, this is just another application. So you have to prepare yourself for different type of applications, and n number of applications are available and most of them are on open platforms. Only problem is we have to adopt those technologies. And always there is a system in the society. Wherever there is a failure in the society, so academia, academic institutions, and teachers are held responsible. So I am just against this particular concept, because academic institutions and teachers are the reflection of the society. And I always give two important examples to understand about this concept is, when Abraham Lincoln sent his son to school, he wrote a letter to the principal and he said, you have to ensure that he is not getting any privilege being a son of the president of US. And whatever punishment you are giving, if it is wise, if he is having the knowledge, I will accept it. But what is happening in present circumstances? We all teacher, we every day encounter with the request from the parents. If at all parents are coming to the institution, their first request is, I am ready to pay the fees, but the student will not come to the colleges. Parent is only required. Second request they always made, somehow you make sure that my son or daughter is passing the examination. And third request they are offering is provide him a good placement and job. So this is the expectation of the society. And this is the problem of the society when the society is focusing on byproduct instead of product. Earlier, a student used to come to the institutions for knowledge, and financial gains and job is what the byproduct. But this total focus of the society is on byproduct. So this is the responsibility of academia to teach the students, at the same time educate the society as well, so that they can focus on the product instead of byproduct. And if we talk about the other approaches about the academia as concerned, there are several things are there on the different platforms. And what is expected right now is we have to think about the integration of machine learning, and it is not important to include everything in the syllabus. when we are talking about integration of this information technology into teaching, I never meant to replace the teacher, because there is no education system where teaching anything can replace the teachers. So teachers are required. Nobody should advocate like we can reduce the number of teachers, but we have to ensure that teachers sitting in the institution can connect the student with through the internet and electronic media. Why this is required? I have mentioned, because the dynamic this pharmaceutical industry is highly technology driven industry, and the half life is of the technology is always very, very short. So if you have to survive, you have to keep on learning. I have mentioned 70% of this staff is not up to the appropriated having knowledge of electronics. So what is required? What is the requirement? Requirement is they should be able to learn different tools and techniques simultaneously while they are working. And for this, academia can play a big role. And what is the role? We have to make them a lifelong learner. Because if you are not able to ensure that you are a lifelong learner, you will not be able to command the respect and you will not be able to survive in the society. So what people always say, if there is a gap between industry and academia, and yes, there is a gap, and this will again persist for years together, because the dynamic industry is changing every day, and no industry can provide the teaching the different tools for the training and all that. So there is a need to have a good mechanism of simulated learning, because most of the industry are US FDA and other regulatory approved in industry, and where they ensure that there is a minimum intervention of the human being. So no industry can provide 100% training to all the graduates, but with the help of simulated methods. So there must be a room in the academic institution where we are giving a real time training to the simulated method. At the same time, there is a need to have a reversed, engineering relationship with the industry. Earlier, industry providing the training to the students, but nowadays, industry is looking toward the industry to train their own manpower, because they cannot afford this type of luxury in their organization. So if industry academic institutions are ready to cater the needs of those industry, so they can provide this type of job work to industry to train their new recruits, and that way while we are teaching and training the new recruitee in the academic industry, a pharmaceutical industry, so somehow they will be able to ensure that they are keeping themselves abreast with the latest development in the industry. So there are different models where we can learn. And learning teaching pedagogy is not very focused or unified for all, fit in all purpose. Because as far as teacher is concerned, there are only two things are required. A teacher should have sufficient goods to deliver. And second, he should have a desire to deliver the goods. If you have these two things, sufficient goods to deliver and desire to deliver, you can consider yourself as a good teacher. And for that, whatever required, you will adopt those technologies, because you know the capacity of different students. There is a concept of uniqueness of students. According to this uniqueness model, BFORM syllabus is designed. There is a concept of optional paper. If you are interested in a particular field, you can opt that paper. Say, for example, if you're interested in regulatory, if you're interested in pharmacy practice, you can take this paper. Then comes the pharmacy practice school. So whatever paper you have taken, if you are working during this practice school in the academic institution and followed by a full project, it means you must have an unique, opportunity to grow yourself according to needs of your own interest. If you're interested in pharmaceutical industry, you can choose all such things in the pharmaceutical industry field. If you're interested in regulatory, you can take in the regulatory. So there are certain observations are there. And if teachers and academic institutions are providing such solutions, so we can say that you can improve the employability of the graduates. As far as the training is concerned, there is no need to teach everyone the same skills, because the concept of the syllabus is the concept of the commons. It means this syllabus are devised or framed looking to the average competence of the students. And what I am just urge upon all the teachers, please remember the limit. There is a no limit as far as over and above the syllabus is concerned. Minimum, you have to cover this much of contents in the classrooms, but over and above the prescribed syllabus is never ever a bar. And this is your responsibility. So in which field you are developing the competence and you are disseminating those knowledge and those skills to your students, you must be recognized in society. And I have mentioned as this is the concept of uniqueness. So this is time to identify different institution and this time for the institution to identify their own uniqueness. I can give you an example. Last year I was in US and I was visiting this Albany College of Pharmacy. And this dean, when given a presentation, he never mentioned anything about the PhD and research. So out of curiosity, I asked, you have not mentioned anything about a PhD program? He simply said, we didn't have any PhD program. We again asked, what is the problem? Why don't you have your Sony anything about research? He said, we have no component of research in our institution. Institution was established in 1780. This is the age of this institution. They said, we are not having any PhD program and we are not having any research component. We asked why this is happening. He said, the founders of this institution had a vision to focus on pharmacy practice. So more than 100 years, we are focusing on pharmacy practice. This is uniqueness. So institution can identify themselves as a unique institute, as well as teachers, the faculty members can also identify themselves as a unique, because we are unique gift of the God. There is no similar persons that are available on this earth. So you have to understand your uniqueness. You have to respect your uniqueness. And once you identify your uniqueness, and if you are working in the same line, you must be considered expert in this particular area. So, and if you are having the expertise in any particular field, and accordingly, you have to adopt different technologies, tools, and techniques. So that you will keep on learning, you will be on toes, and while you are helping the students to grow themselves, but at the same time, you are also growing as per the needs in the society. So all such examples I can give you. There are certain methods like personalized adaptive learning. So there are different tools. So there's need not to enumerate each and everything, but you just see what is the expectation of that particular student, and according to the capacity of that particular student, you can devise the mechanism and methods for the delivery of the contents. And one more important thing I can mention here, it is mentioned, I mentioned also here also, if there is a need to have a understand the coordinates of the profession. You need not to focus on very pinpointed, because BPharm is an integrated course. Whenever you are talking about professional course, they are integrated courses. And you are supposed to be, people says at times criticize that we are jack of all, master of none, but that is required. And this concept is not new concept. Even the Shushruta Sanhita has mentioned, Ekam Sastram Adhiyano Navidya Cha Sastram Ischayam Tasmat Bahushut Sastaya Vijaniya Cha Chikitsaha. What does it mean? It means a physician who learned one science only cannot be sure of his own science, Ayurveda. And for this reason, the physician has to be well-versed in many other sciences. So when I'm talking about pharmacy, you may be a master of pharmacy, but if you are not having orientation at present time electronics, you will be lost. So you have to earn the different concept of learning, and you have to respect the basic sciences as well, because professional sciences always flourish on the developments and researches of the basic sciences. So you have to respect them, and you have to come out of the shell. You have to coordinate with them, then only you will be able to give the solution. And one other option is observation in our pharmacy profession is, we are very good, we are very excellent in our own domain, but we are not connecting with others. This is high time to connect with others, come out of the shell and deliver. And for this delivery is always possible if you have a desire to serve to the society. There is a couplet in the Sanskrit that Yatha kharas chandan bharvahi bharasya betta natu chandanasya evam hi shastrani bhuti athani mula karvat bahanti. Is tarah se ek chandan ko dhone wala gadha chandan ke bhar ko janta hai, uske gun ko, uski khushbu ko nahi janta. Usi tarah bahut se shastron ko, bahut se formon ko upyog janne wala यदि उसकी मतलब को यदि ट्रांसलेट नहीं कर पा रहा तो भी उस गधे के समान है जो चंदन को ढो रहा है खुशबू नहीं जानता। हमें ये कोशिश करना चाहिए कि व्हाट एवर नॉलेज वी हैव एक्वायर्ड वी समहाउ वी आर एबल टू ट्रांसलेट इट इनटू कमर्शियल गेन्स एंड एबल टू डिलीवर इट टू द स्टूडेंट्स देन ओनली वी विल बी एबल टू सर्वाइव इन द सोसाइटी विद रिस्पेक्ट एंड वी विल बी having satisfaction being most blessed breed on this earth. We are belonging to medical profession. At the same time, we are belonging to a fraternity of teaching. And as far as this cultural heritage is concerned, their teachers are kept at the top. And अपने जो शास्त्रों में भी कहा गया है कि आचार्य देवो भव, लेकिन शास्त्रों में ये भी कहा गया है जब एक लाइन को दोबारा बोला जाता है उसका मतलब बदल जाता है, आचार्य देवो भव, आचार्य देवो भव. It means teacher, you are God. But when it is said twice, it means you are teacher, behave like God. So this is the responsibility of all of us. If we are equivalent to God and at the same time, we are bound to behave like God. So with these words, we have to always open for the new technologies, tools and techniques with a single motto of the well-being of the students. Your each and every activity must be focused on the well-being of the students. And if you are doing this small work, one day you must be recognized, you must be honored and facilitated by this, felicitated by one and all being a good teacher. So, मैं आपसे यही आशा करता हूँ कि इस पृथ्वी पर आप आए हैं, बहुत कम समय मिला है, इस सुंदर ग्रह पे हम रहे हैं, इस सुंदर ग्रह को और सुंदर बना के हम जाएं और आने वाली जनरेशन को ये एक अलग से माइलस्टोन्स देके जाएं कि वो भी सर्व करते रहें. प्रीति के लिए बहुत बहुत बधाई, आपने एक अच्छा आयोजन किया और हमारे लिए एक अपॉर्चुनिटी भी कि हम रास्ते भी अपने साथियों से जुड़ पाए, क्योंकि इस समय में जब हम बहुत ज़्यादा पैंडेमिक की बात कर चुके हैं, वायरस की बात कर चुके हैं, अब ये इसके बाहर निकल के अगली स्ट्रेटजी की बात करने का समय है. आप इस सब पर अच्छी बात करेंगे और मैं आशा करता हूँ कि आपके इसके जो आउटकम होंगे हमारे पास आप भेजेंगे, हम लोग भी इस पर काउंसिल में डिस्कस करेंगे. वॉट एवर सपोर्ट एंड कोऑपरेशन इज एक्सपेक्टेड फ्रॉम द काउंसिल आर एनी रेगुलेटरी बॉडी, आई कैन एश्योर यू आई विल पुट बिफोर द डिफरेंट कमेटी मेंबर्स एंड आई विल मेक श्योर दैट इज डन. सो माई गुड विशेस फॉर दिस पर्टिकुलर webinar and I'm looking forward to have much more, many more activities in times to come and keep on connecting with all the pharmacists and try to help them to come out of the fear psychosis out of this particular virus attack. So once again, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. If still you have any query, I'm here for free 20 minutes. I'll be here if you have any query. So I'll love to respond to those queries. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Very concise way, literally the way and the ascent you have, the holiness and the spiritual way, I really am a big fan of you, and really you have come up with the digital era, digital world in a short span. You have covered all the aspects, like definitely in education and in our healthcare sector it is very much required, since we are working on the in our industry we also adopted artificial intelligence. Even we are working on a various sectors which definitely we need to respect basic science also. We are once we want to be updated ourselves, we want to be promoter, we need to be a multi-talented, we need to be oriented in each and every field. We are having a knowledge, so the concept is only is that that's why I connected engineering as well as pharmacy college with the society, is that really because there are many faculties, many researchers, they don't know how to combat with this platform, because a college has called me that we have a practical deliberation, Viva was through the virtual way. So I'm like, how people will connect? So this practice we need to adopt, and you have covered all the aspects of machine learning, and that is really a need of time. And so I just wanted to know that in a PCI you also imparted pharmacy, e-pharmacy.
Electronic learning.
Yeah, electronic learning, e-pharmacy. That's why we during this COVID-19 pandemic, it's really works. People
actually, you have asked a very good question. I have mentioned also in a very polite manner. There was reluctance.
But it works.
It works, nahi. What I mean to say is, all accreditation bodies and University Grants Commission always talking about blended learning.
Yeah.
But there was reluctance. There was reluctance from all the corners. Nobody was ready to adopt the learning through e-platforms. But thanks to this particular pandemic that you have adopted technologies. So we can understand this importance, and we were giving this emphasis for last 30 years. And particularly when there was a concept of the learning, this cone of learning and Bloom's taxonomy and modified Bloom's taxonomies. So they are talking about the different level of learning. And that is only possible through the electronic media, because there is a concept of on-site, online assessment of the learning outcome. If you are talking about outcome-based learning, so without the help of this electronic media, you cannot do it. It's next to impossible. You are delivering a topic, immediately you are throwing a MSQ through the mobile devices, and with no time, it must be responded by the students. At the same time, in the form of result, it is there with the computer of the teacher. Once you adopted this particular concept, you will say, how free you are, how light you are as far as the workload is concerned. And that way, instead of working doing a lot of manual job, you will have sufficient time to have the quality reading and quality thinking. So this is already there. And I think you should recommend this also, because this is the recommendation of University Grants Commission, All India Institute of Technology, Pharmacy Council of India, and NAC, to have the always ongoing research and pedagogy. So it is adopted. That is important, and credit goes to COVID-19, not for all of us.
Yeah, we need to find the optimistic condition even in any worst crisis. So it's something like that, because now we are more prone towards the e-learning aspects and this virtual platform. While we are connected, Zoom is not Zoom, and this are not new for us, but we are learned in this indeed crisis time. So really, it's hats off that our team is working. And so I'm just asking that since this pandemic has come, what now PCI has taken a plan for a future, like it's survive for a longer time. Even our Madhya Pradesh RGBU University has postponed the exams. Even they plan to promote the students. So how we can continuously engage our students and researchers in this education system? So have you, I think this is new strategy.
What I have mentioned in my lecture also, probably you have not sincerely listened to my response.
No, I listened.
I'm just out of lighter when I'm saying, because ideation in any science is totally missing. What is happening in the world, only metaphysicists, they are predicting. Like Stephen Hawking, what he said about this artificial intelligence 30 years back, today, tomorrow, 25 years down the line, it will happen, it must be reality. And he warns also, the real success in artificial intelligence will write the script of end of human being. That was his worries. We are not predicting this. Then comes Bill Gates. He said in a TED Talks in 2005, 15, I believe, he said, the world is not prepared for pandemic. And he gave a TED Talks, and he has compared the influenza virus with the cloud out of nuclear explosion. That was his vision. Pharmacists and medical professionals, they are not predicting. Then there is Steve Jobs. He said, there must be biggest invention in the years to come. There must be invention intersection between medical sciences and IT. And IBM, above Watson, they are already 40 pipelines are there. They'll be, anytime they'll be in the market. So they are working.
Exactly.
So they are predicting. Stephen, this Alvin Toffler in 1984 said in his one of the very famous book, Future Socks, man must be surrounded by the machines like a machine. So everybody was laughing at the time, but what is happening? Even we are sitting in a family and we are surrounded by the machines. So we have to learn this concept of forecasting. I have mentioned we should form a small group in our institution so that there they put a lot of work on ideation. Because what is said by this, I think Albert Einstein only said, imagination is the most important than the knowledge. Because knowledge is limited, but imagination encircles
infinite.
Encircles the earth as well, and beyond the earth as well. So, but there is no component of ideation in this country. So we have to evolve this mechanism. And as far as PCI is concerned, about this pandemic is concerned, so there are two strategies, because this is crisis management. So there is a central agency which gives the guidelines. So we should follow the directives of those guidelines. Once this is settled, so we have to adopt certain mechanism. But as far as this virus is concerned, this taught us a lesson that we have to prepare for the future, and there must be different viruses in years to come. So we have to prepare to live with those viruses without hampering our day-to-day activity. So we have to equip with ourselves with great immunity, our gears like masks and other things. So this is the thing. But as far as the examinations and all that concerned, all the agencies are taking जो भी डिसीजन ले रहे हैं वो अपना जो क्राइसिस मैनेजमेंट की नेशनल बॉडी है उसकी डायरेक्शन में ले रहे हैं. लेकिन लर्निंग के लिए देयर इज नो एंड. आई एम रियली हैप्पी स्टूडेंट्स आर लर्निंग. दे आर अटेंडिंग लेक्चर्स. टीचर्स आर अप्लाइंग द मटेरियल. एट द सेम टाइम डिफरेंट इंटरनेशनल एंड नेशनल प्लेटफॉर्म्स आर फ्रीली अवेलेबल. Only thing, this is the response of the teachers to make the students aware about the availability of materials and information through different mode of electronic media. So whenever we discuss about the this roadmap in years to come, we will certainly cover all such observations, and we will ensure that the learning is on, whether it's a pandemic, whether it's class, whether it's no class. We will make sure the learning should not be hampered anyway.
Yeah, really, sir. Well said. Imagination is must required beyond because it's infinite. If you have that power of thinking, imaginations, then practically you can work. And learning is something is like whatever the crisis has come. Learning should be continuous. It's never to be stopped. And thank you so much, sir. Yeah. And
I will just intervene again. Albert Einstein again said one important thing.
Yes, sir.
Beyond the electric power and this atomic power, the biggest motivation is willpower.
Willpower.
Like we say, teachers are full of willpower. So they have shown their competence. They are commanding respect. And again, with their willpower, they will keep on commanding the respect, and they will bring the knowledge to this country.
Exactly, sir. A few questions I have received. I'm inviting Dr. Bhuvan Chandra. He is a principal, Ideal Institute of Technology, WADA. Sir, can you please share your words? And Dr. Sunil Singh also.
Very good afternoon, one and all. First of all, I am surprised that the genius of pharmacy is genius of digital era also. Because I am from computer science field, and I have seen the era of 84 and 85. We are having Pascal, Fortran, so and so things, and now we are coming to this this day. So I am very thankful to Professor Dr. Shailendra Sarafji, Vice President, Pharmacy Council of India. He has given a lot of new idea. And basically what I think that everything gives us a new opportunity, new thinking, new imagination. I have not ever thought that COVID-19 will force us or give us such opportunity that we can teach our students from home. Though initially we were having difficulty to train our teachers, But nowadays, I am seeing that even the schools and other institutions, they are very much expertise in this field. And I hope that many new tools, many new things will come in this area. And basically, this information communication technology, because we have to communicate. So for communication, we need, we can have computer, we can have laptop. So we need the towers also. We need satellites, a lot of things. So in this area, or India is far ahead from many countries.
Yes.
Because the vision of Rajiv Gandhi in 84-85, it has given India a boost in the field of computer. And that's why I hope that this is the reason that in this COVID-19, we are able to handle each and everything. Even the many universities are taking practicals, Viva, examinations online. So I hope that every difficulty gives us the new opportunity.
Yes.
Thanks again to Shailendra ji.
Thank you, Dr. Bhuvan.
Salutation to
when you are talking about the use of internet and this computers, so very soon we will have to face the problem of this quantum computing. Again, we have to learn a lot of things.
Sure, sir. We are in recent days, we will having computers having 100 times the speed.
Yes.
Of
yes,
the
yes.
100 times the speed, sir. 100 times.
Thank you, Mr. Good work, nice words.
Thanks.
Moving towards our lectures session. So since we are connected virtually, sir, please accept the token of remembrance from our side that you have joined us in this webinar. And thank you so much, sir. And now I would like to.
Thank you, Preeti. Rather, you people deserve this bouquet of flowers because you are doing a lot of good work and you are connecting during this pandemic. So my good wishes on behalf of myself and on behalf of the council. And thank you very, very much for nice words. Thank you.
Now I would like to, sir, I would like to welcome our
first. Thank you very much, sir.
I would like to welcome our first resource person, yes. Dr. Prasoon Sharma, researcher at ATWAS Loran University and joint researcher at UNIDEP Hungary. Today she is going to give her deliberation on strategies to be used for maximizing outcomes in digital learning. She was born and brought up from the India, but for her research work, now she is in Hungary, and she is having well-known command on these digital learning platforms. So I would like to invite her once again to her deliberation.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. I hope I'm audible to everyone. Am I?
Yes, you are audible. You need to share a screen share from your side.
All right. So here we are moving towards my presentation. So what Yes?
I think you also brief yourself.
Okay, fine.
That will be good. That will be honored to hear from your side about your achievements, everything.
Oh, thank you so much. Till now, I have achieved ICSSR doctoral fellowship. Other than that, I got one more fellowship from Hungary. And with those fellowship, I'm working there in Hungary as a postdoctoral research. And basically, my work is from pedagogical sciences. And now I'm working in the area of pedagogical sciences itself. So I have my presentation on insights from pedagogical perspective to enhance the e-learning process. So one thing when I was there in my teacher training college, I just had one quote from John Dewey. That thing was like, school is the miniature society. It means how the society works is reflected on our education system. So what is there is like, if society is suffering or society is having some sort of other demands, then our educational institutions are going to adopt them as it is their need, because it reflects from the society, as it is wisely mentioned by Professor Shailendra. And I would like to congratulate that it was really insightful initiative from your institution, as well as a great work that you might be taking up. Aside from having problems and everything, now we are moving towards our opportunities, what we actually can do for our nation, for the present situation of the education institutions. So yeah, I'm going with this. Basically, what I wanted to let you know about, I have taken the concept that each and every individual is well aware about the thing that what is online learning platform, but there is a variation within that. One is virtual learning environment. So there, people are having virtual learning environments which are working with the help of internet browsers, where delivery of instructions and assessment tools like quizzes and things are there going on in the colleges. Second one is LMS, that is widely known for everyone, learning management system. Although it exists from a quite long back, but I think the theory of evolution works here, because we were wanting to do things, but we were not able to. But due to the pandemic situation, things were happening. Because when the situations are there, we need to face them. We need to have a concrete step to just break down those things. Now we are on that path only. Now we have CMS, that is content management system. It is a kind of reservoir. Like as we have dams and things, so reservoir is a collection of water. In the same way, we are having the CMS. CMS contains data about documents, videos, pictures, and content, studies related stuff. And last one is LCMS, which is a new version which combines CMS and LMS both. So now we are at the edge when we wanted to combine all of them and get a new sort of learning platform which can cater our all needs. And we also wanted to have virtual experience for our students too. Now, for the next thing, we might be known about knowing the things about issues of online teaching and learning. We regularly facing them. We are regularly having problems. So first thing which I have observed out of too many classes I have observed from teacher educators, from educators of different colleges. So I get one point, that is guide teacher program. So if orientation is not given in the proper way, then it is definitely going to have a difficulty to the teacher or the educator to have acceptability or to just fit in themselves in the, like you are a vertical shape and you wanted to fit that particular vertical thing into a horizontal shape. So it is something which cannot happen until unless you just modify that shape into a horizontal one, then only you can get an optimum outcome. Next thing is students devoid of enthusiasm. When everyone is into the classical classroom setting, they're chit-chatting with their friends and having very cheerful environment of teaching, and all of a sudden they are isolated. So in that situation, they lose enthusiasm. So if we really want to catch their attention, make sure that they feel integrated in your class. Second thing is feedback versus feed forward technique. You might be heard of, you might be aware about the feedback thing, but when it comes to feed forward, what is that? Feed forward is like having a feedback system before starting your lecture. It means what you really wanted to have in your next class. So have a feed forward technique. You, what they want, just take their views prior to your class and implement it in your classroom. That will more will be more beneficial rather than taking feedbacks and just forget about the things that what is going to be in the next situation. Second thing is confusion in selecting e-platform. Nowadays, we are having a lot of e-learning platforms. Things are like a bit confusing, what to opt, what not to opt. It is a confusion from institutions. So what institution do? They just go for the most common thing. Like we are in Zoom. So other than Zoom, we are having a lot of variety of technological platforms. So what they feel like that it is a confusion, so go for the common thing. Here, what we can do is explore a bit, and whenever we are deciding and we are making our curriculum, at that time, we should go for the adaptable learning digital curriculum. So earlier, it was not known to us that this situation is going to happen to us. So now what we have done is we just randomly, it was too soon, too fast for us to implement things that is why we were not organized. Now we have time. Now we have situation when we can plan a curriculum in the way that it should be planned. That is how we can implement our educational, enhance our education system well. Second, now next thing is give the learners opportunity. Make a learner's choice as a major thing. It means learner's choice should be the prior thing. Because as it is mentioned in most of the pedagogical things, that education should be student-centered or learner-centered. That is why we should focus on the learner-centered education system, embracing adaptability. So what I would like to tell you, adaptability. Why adaptability? Because when you see in your classroom surrounding, when a student comes from a different language and sits in your class and that person is like, whoa, what is happening in my class? You are teaching in English and that student belongs to a Marathi background and he or she is not able to understand what is happening in their class. In that situation, that student is not able to adapt your class. Similarly, is happening with the students at this time. Earlier, they were in a proper classroom setting and now all of a sudden they are banged into an online setting. So they need to be adaptable. And from your students' part, from the teacher's part, everyone need to have adaptable situations where they can sit back comfortably and teach, focus on the actual teaching and learning rather than technological issues and having problems and every time tackling the internet issue and these things. So aside from these things, we need to focus on teaching and learning, which is our main focus. Next is IT, using IT tools, apps, and resources. What I feel like students are more capable in adapting IT tools rather than teachers, because it is the technological era and they are just born with that skill. They are dealing with those, but not with the educational one. They are dealing with the social thing. They are dealing with the tools and apps which are for entertainment purposes. Now they need to shift their interest from the entertainment to the education. There are a lot of variety of opportunities there by which they can utilize those apps and resources. Next is what we need to do. Five compelling reasons to involve in e-learning. Other than coronavirus pandemic, we do have other objectives like delivering accelerated training. So if I think most of the students are from pharmaceuticals, so delivering accelerated training. So for teachers, I know that online teacher training programs, some of the institutions teacher training programs via online mode. Now it is turned for other industries like engineering industry, like pharmaceutical industry to have an online training setup. Why online training setup? Because it is the need of first thing. Second thing, by which they can expand their opportunity to the next global level. If your students will have accelerated, because whenever you are sending your students for a training program, what you expect that after the completion of their degree, they are supposed to be there in the actual surroundings where they need to integrate the industries of pharmacy. So what at this time, what is needed, not only for the local level, just train your students up to the global level, and this e-learning platform will definitely going to help you in that. Second thing is address demographic changes. So as I know that not only at the local level, we are moving forward. We are having a global scenario. We need to integrate our opportunities to the global leaders of pharmaceuticals. We need to have integration from big agencies, from big institutions, which are working really well in this area. So demographic bars are not there. You are not supposed to have like a rigid boundary that we can only have training from particular area. We can have training from like all around the globe. Next thing is cater the global workforce. When you are training your students up to the global mark, then you are training your students to be fit to the opportunity of global level at any in any country, at any point of time. Because in pharmaceuticals, what is happening in healthcare, pharmaceutical area, you are having bloom of opportunities. This is the right time for your institutions, for your colleges, to train your students for the better and better opportunity. Because it is the right time when you are having bloom in the opportunities, you are having higher demand for employment, you are having higher demand for innovations in your area, you are having higher demands to cater the emergencies or to deal with the emergency situations. So now in this condition, you are really having opportunity to deal with any situation like that. Making learning accessible. How we can make learning accessible? Why I have put this thing? Because what we need to do is like dealing with all the students' need, except from their disability too. So here we are not talking about the students from the general classroom, but students from the general classroom who are having learning disability, who are having physical disability. So we can cater the needs of all types. If one student is having a hearing impairment, that student can also work in this area. That student's learning needs can also be catered, providing risk-free learning environment. Because situation is like that, you are having virus situation, you are having a lot of other situations where you might not be having proper funds to make your students be physically active to at many places where too much risk is there. You need to have PPE kit, you need to have a lot of saving things. In that situation, you can save your students and give them a risk-free learning environment for the future. Now, for the teachers, I now move to the teachers from the students. So first thing is effective utilization of platforms. Why? Because it is the need of the hour. Open for creativity and innovation, integration and cohesiveness, interactive classes, and effective assessment. So now I'm moving into the depth of these things. Effective utilization of e-learning platform. How you can utilize e-learning platforms in the most effective way. Ensure the students' involvement through activities. Make sure they are the part of the class. Not only they are listening to the lectures, they are being there and just training themselves for the future exams, nothing like that. They need to be involved, and actual learning should be catered. threaded discussion. So I think many of the teacher educators are well aware about this fact that learning should be in a spiral form. Discussion should be connected to each other. It need to have a threaded connections from one concept to another concept. So it is easier to go by the flow rather than going jumping from one place to another. So that is how you can continue your education system in e-learning mode also. Chat rooms should be monitored by the teachers. Grade books, like each and every student should be graded according to their performance, not only in the assessment thing, but also in your classroom performance. Token economy. This actually works for the high schoolers and college students too, but token economy is a kind of initiative which can be given to the student. If some student perform really well in your class, then you can give that student a token. That token will be beneficial for the future assessment, that if a student perform up to the from the 50 marks, he performed 40, that a token will be of 5 marks, so that additional 5 marks will be added into the assessment of the student. That will encourage other students to be engaged in the class and perform really well. Analytics, it means students or the teachers should be more active, and the analysis of the assessment should be shown to the students time to time. It is really important from the part of the teachers, because if they are not showing what is happening and what is their performance in their class, then how they are going to assess themselves. So students' performance and students' analytics should be shown to the student. Group pages. So like here, I would like to mention that students' learning group pages should be created, where they can feel like they are there in the class and they can discuss about the things. Next is, I would like to mention some of the special features available in the e-learning platforms, like special features from Blackboard. It is having suites of application. And in Moodle, we are having a filtration system. In D2Ls, we are having a portfolio feature. So these features can have a very good impact on the students, and you can utilize your e-learning platforms in a better way. Next one is utilize peer-to-peer social media platform. Why peer-to-peer social media platform? Because all the students are there in the class, need to feel like the class. So in that situation, they can discuss. So Edmodo is one of the free educational social networking application where students can discuss what was there in the class, and they can have a good communication and discussion about their class. Next one is freely available platforms. So I think you might be aware about the Moodles, and Zoom is well known. Other than that, there are many other opportunities where freely available platforms are there. So one is Sakai, Latitude Learning, Jokios, CourseSight by Blackboard, and VizIQ, Adopt Captivate. Captivate is really good for the students of having a physical disability, if they are having learning like hearing impairment or something. This tool can be really useful for them. Then is Elucidate. Next one is Lectora Inspire. Lectora is also very good for the having students from variety of backgrounds, so you can involve them. Next one is Decibo, and next one is Microsoft Teams, which is well known. And last one is Edmodo. It is a kind of social media platform for peer-to-peer discussions. Next, I would like to tell you how you should continue with the online process. So being a teacher, what is really important? So being a teacher, it is really important to plan first. Planning, there are things like before stepping into the class, you need to plan a lot of things. In the physical classroom also, you need to plan a lot. So same here, you are supposed to plan things like content, which is really feasible for the online teaching. not only the slides and PPT thing, but also some activities, involvement consideration things. And next is class. You should know how you are going to have a proper time management of your class. And third one is setup. So what is going to be your setup? You need to have a proper plan regarding that. Next one is iterate. Iterate is like an intermediation of the work, plan, deliver, and access. So here, when you know that before after planning, what is next? You need to have a proper delivery, where you need to give them, give the students what is required to them, not in the terms of having a bulky content, but also in the, not only in that content, but in the context of having crisp and to the point, pinpointed concept, which is really useful for them. Other than that, other things you can leave to the student, where they can explore, they can have a good idea what is going to happen and how they can go and research their own content for having better understanding. Next is accessibility. So here everything is like interrelated and everything is overlapped. So accessibility of teaching, accessibility of learning, because learning is happening from both the parts, not only from the teacher's part, not only from the learner's part, it is from the teacher's part too. So we usually in educational sciences, what we used to usually call that not a lesson plan, we used to call it as learning plan, learning from teacher's part, from the student's part. So everyone is in a learning process, because learning is a lifelong process. Everybody needs to learn from like, not only needs, it is like a compulsory process which is happening without your conscious mind is like knowing that you are learning, but learning is happening. Last one is delivery, content delivery, mode, and the media. And ultimately we are having this cycle of teaching in the online mode. So after delivery, we next plan next for the other class. So this is how we are working. So next one is, I just came with a pathway which I found after the observation of like hundreds of institutions from India. So I have been there in Bihar, I have been there for observation from Kerala, from Orissa, from Madhya Pradesh, from UP, from various parts of India. So ultimately I came with one concept that we can apply in our classroom structure. First thing, prepare for the classroom structure, get ready with the technical team and supporting educational content. Third one is arranging and establishing teacher learning sphere. And fourth one is conducting interactive classes. Why interactive? Because ultimately we need to focus our students, and if they are passive in your class, then we can't assure that they are learning or not. So what I suggest here is a kind of flipped online class. Flipped online class. Till now we have been hearing about the flipped classroom in normal classroom settings. Now we can have an online flipped classroom where 3 days we can continue with the normal classroom lecture method, and for 3 days, not only just simple lecture method, but the interactive classroom lecture method. And for the next 3 days, we can assign students some task or some project. We can give them some research to do. And in the next 3 days of our flipped classroom, we are asking them what they have got. Like a teacher can randomly have students' name. For that also, like students generally blamed for, teachers are generally blamed for having partial behavior. So for that, we are having one more application. So that application is known as hands-on application. So randomly, you just put your classroom names and that application will give you a random name. And you will ask that random student to give your responses what is given, whatever task is given by the teachers. So that student will present. And in that condition, each and every student is going to be like active in your class, that at any point of time, their names can come out and they need to present. So this is how you can work in a simple classroom setting, but a flipped method. It can give you a better engagement of the students, and it can give you better motivation of the students. So, and this is how you can work in your classroom settings. And ultimately, final thing is like having a good assessment method. Assessment, generally, we are following the semester. So semester system do have formative assessment and summative assessment. So in the combined, in online setting also, you need to combine both the things, formative, summative, as well as having more discussions, having more quizzes, having projects, and keep them engaged in your class. So this is how you can build a very good rapport with the students and make the students that they belong to the class. Next thing is teacher and student both need to be open for creativity and innovation, not just having a similar leak what is happening in the past and we are regularly doing, keep on repeating the similar things. We need to have open-mindedness and we need to be more conscious what is happening around the globe, what is there in what you can do as a creative person and how you can innovate not only your class. If you are a student, then how you can collaborate your efforts into the classroom. Here, I have some activities that teacher can do. Padlet is one of our activity which I have taken as an example, which can be taken by the teacher. If I go with the Padlet, then I'll tell you what is happening there. So here I have already opened the Padlet. Wait, it is not working. Is it? All right. So this is the Padlet background. So yes.
You need to stop that screen share and then start this again.
No, madam. It is visual, madam.
Okay. Wait, I can continue again started. So here we are again starting with the activity part. So Padlet is one of the activity website by which you can have different canvases, walls, grid lines, and not only that, maps and things are there where you can involve your students and have more interactive sessions. So for engineering students, for students from different backgrounds, so they can be there and have interactive sessions. And now we are again moving towards our other than this, we have quiz maker for assessment, and other activities can also be run with this mode only. And here we are going again with our slides. So what was next thing is required for the gamification. So Jamboard, in activities also, we are having one more thing, that is Jamboard. It is a kind of interactive whiteboard by which students and teachers can collaborate and have discussion via whiteboard method, as we used to do in our classroom. Next one is gamification. Everyone knows that how students are get involved in the games and having more creative things. So here I have mentioned two gamification of the classroom. One is Minecraft education and next one is Verticonomics. So Minecraft can be used for having students from various backgrounds, but Verticonomics can be used for the business students and can be used for the students from economics and students from commerce and these sectors. Next one is virtual experience. So here I have mentioned one website which is like very common for all, Google Earth. So this can be really useful for the students of architecture, that you can apply this tool and make the students be there and show them the street view, how this or that building looks like. You can be sitting in your rooms and can visit at various places around the globe via Google Earth only. So next one is online libraries, because many of the students are struggling to have quality content. Why? Because they know that whatever is happening on the Google is the right thing. Whatever is there in the Google is the correct thing. But actually, it is not true. People without having any proper research, they also do post content, and which is really harmful for the students if they go with that. So here, we need to ensure our students are taking quality content from the quality resources. And this is how we can monitor them to have a good quality environment. Next one is global sphere of learning. So this pandemic situation is not only for a country like India. It is having here in Hungary, it is a big problem around the globe, because of this problem around the globe, we are facing types of problems. So ultimately, when it comes with the problems, it comes with the solutions and more opportunities too. So we need to take things more positive. Now, first thing is contact to the global society. Students need to connect with the global society. If they are keeping themselves in a nutshell, like in a shell, then they won't be learning at the global level. So if they really wanted to learn something at the global level, they need to have a good connection with the global knowledge society. And it is free. Too many universities and reputed institutions are providing free membership to the students, to the institutions. They can directly go and connect to them, like UNICEF is connecting with students and teachers and institutions. UNESCO is connecting with them. And not only that, they are providing more opportunities to be there and to learn a lot. Next one is, I think this point was mentioned by Shailen sir also, that collaborations, it is right time to have collaborations for institutions, because most of the reputed institutions are open for having online collaborations. So institutions who are really forward-looking for the future, who really wanted to, like institutions like PRISL, really wanted to flourish yourself, then in that condition, you need to collaborate with the international institutions, where your students can virtually visit their institutions, learn a lot, and you can make a mark at the international level. Next thing is join global courses. So there are too many opportunities to join global courses. Thousands and thousands of online courses are there, and it is freely available for anyone without any age bar, without any limit that you need to be a student, you need to be a teacher. No, nothing like that. And institutions which are like well-known, Harvard University, University of Cambridge, University of Macedonia, Athos Lauren University, and other than that, UNESCO, UNICEF, and Coursera, edX, these all are providing free online courses, and not only in medical background, but also in other courses. Like if you really are interested in languages, you can go for languages. You can learn a new language that can expand your opportunities up to the next level. Other than that, if you are an engineer, if you really wanted to learn some other engineering concepts, then you are most welcome. Go and join. Too many global courses are there. You can join according to your choice and have a good learning opportunity, and just grab it, because it is the right time to be a part of a global course or to be a part of a global community. And next one is limitless opportunities, because I think that in pharmaceuticals only, you can see that it is flourishing. And not only that, teaching area in engineering, too many website requirements are there. So all the people from computer sciences can go and have show their skills and have more opportunities. Not only from your country, from other countries too. If you belong to India and if you really have capacity, then you can have good appointment in Sweden. You can have good appointment at Venezuela. So whatever you wanted to, just make sure that your willpower and what you actually wanted to do is really strong. And endless opportunities are there without any foundation. If you have your secondary objective, like at present you are a teacher, but what earlier you wanted to become a singer. So why don't get a new skill? So it can be having a secondary aspect of yourselves. So it is an endless opportunity for everyone. Next is integration and cohesion enhancement approach. So this is the kind of approach on which I have gone through for the student. Actually, many teachers and educational institutions, like they are having trouble that students' interactivity is not there and they are not engaged in the classroom. They lost their motivation. So this is how we can ensure that students are involved in your classroom. First thing is social cohesiveness. Second thing is task cohesion. So whenever you are providing some tasks, make sure that need to cater what actually students want. So it is aligned with your course, with the students' requirement, and with the society requirements too. Next is inclusivity, because it need to be have inclusion of students, of teachers, and your content. Next is joint focus, and completely focus on what you actually want. Because here, learning outcome is the major point. And learning outcome will be achieved when your students are more interactive and having more they are cognitively engaged in your class. Not only physically present in your class, but also cognitively they are engaged in your class. So this will be reflected in your students' performance and student engagement. Next, how a teacher can ensure that your class is going to be more cohesive and having more integration. So first thing is work organizer and the teaching learning planner. So for most effective teaching learning aspect, you can have a good time management. And this is how you can have a good classroom cohesiveness. So for this, I have one example that Zoom also is having Chrome extensions for planning meetings and things like that. So you can apply that. Second thing is develop a clear and consistent structure. So make sure if you do not have a proper structure, then building cannot be built in without any structure. If you randomly put bricks and bricks over bricks, then it is going to have a disastrous building. So ultimately, if you really wanted to make a good building, then you need to have a consistent and a clear structure. And this is how the education system works. Timely report writing. And this, as I mentioned earlier, that the student need to be reported timely how they have performed. Their performance should be reported to them. Next is pre-planned adaptive digital curricula. So that curriculum should be planned according to the digital, because in the next session you are going to start with this situation. So we need to have a proper planning. Next is access to up-to-date primary source material. Why primary source? Because whenever we are going with the secondary source, so generally things and the content data may differ from primary to secondary source because they are reporting. So if you are becoming third and tertiary resource, then you might be having flaws in your content. And this is how you need to update your teaching learning content. Reflect and revise. So reflection from the teacher's part and reflection from the student's part. Make sure teachers do have a self-assessment checklist. It may be available at NCERT website. You can go with that. In NCERT, you will be having a teacher's self-reflection tool. So you can take that tool and just reflect on that how you performed. So if you really improve yourself as a teacher, then you can have that self-reflection. And as a student, as a learner, what you need to do is make a checklist by your own and have what you actually learned today, what you wanted to learn. If you are lacking in that learning, then how much efforts you need to put. because the classroom teaching is not only end that a learner can do. So if a learner really wanted to improve it, its learning, then that learner can go with the other sources and enhance its learning. So it is opportunity, not only stick to your classroom teaching and learning, just go beyond it. And if you are interested, like you are keen to know about like next classroom content, then be ready with that. As a learner, it is really good to have a prior knowledge. When teacher is going to teach, then you are going to have proper content in your brain to reflect upon. So this is how teaching learning can be more cohesive. Next is integration. Online learning and blended classroom can be brought into the classroom situation. That is how you can integrate your students. So mix match and do what is required for your classroom teaching. Next is project-based activities incorporating technology. This is how you can involve students. Game-based learning and assessment. So as I have mentioned, gamification is one of the like interesting thing for the students. So why not provide them game-based learning assessment? Next is learning with mobile and handheld devices. So provide them some sort of activities which can be done with the help of mobile. Like you can have make the students of pharmaceuticals know about the situation, what is happening around. So give them a questionnaire, tell them to circulate that questionnaire with their mobile phone. And if they circulate, they will be having a good survey around from their society only. So it can be a good opportunity for them to know what is required in the society, whether they are afraid or what they want in their healthcare system. So this is how surveys can be done. So next is instructional tools like interactive whiteboards, students' performance systems, and web-based projects, exploration, researchers, students created media like podcast, videos, slideshare. So like here, what we need to do is like taking student at the front. So make them like if one student is having good communication skills, make that student use their learnings, like use their skills. So that student can come with a video. If that student submit a video, then their assessment can be done on the basis of that video. If a student is good in speech, then in that case, a podcast can be made and slideshows. And other than that, they can animate. Whatever they want, they need to have proper scope. Next is boosting e-learning interaction. So here, interaction can be facilitated with the help of Edmodo, with the help of Schoology, with the help of Webly, with the help of Moodle. Start live class discussion with today's meet. So I'm giving you some of the other platforms which can be used for a special feature thing. So here, specially, Edmodo, Schoology, Webly, and these things are for the more interactive sessions. So live discussion for today's meet, we can use for live discussions. Use Poll Everywhere as one of the polling system that I have mentioned as a survey thing, and Socrative for the tool like poll students. Explore enhance digital note taking with the Evernote. Digital note taking like audio note taking, this can happen with the help of Google Notes also, Google Docs also. Next is students can create videos by using Animoto. I mentioned that animation can be done by the students. It is the easiest tool by which students can do animation. Collaborate using apps like Whiteboard and tool like Nearboard. So these tools can be used by the students and teachers for having more interactive sessions. So here I have mentioned some assessment tools. So Classmaker, Class Tool, What to Learn, Pro Professors Quiz School, Quiz Revolution, Quiz Slides, and Ed Games, and Geo Parity. So here I have given the link in this slides, and I can forward these. I will be forwarding these slides to the administrator and the organizer of the seminar. So you can you can just go with these assessment tools and have a good assessment of students. So I'm here, I'm not going with the technicalities of these tools, but I'm telling you, they are freely available, and some of them are like mildly paid, and some are like reservoir, already having some sort of data, quizzes for engineering, for quizzes for schools, quizzes for students, or quizzes for the teacher educators. So you can use them or modify these quizzes for your teaching classroom. So this is how your assessment can be more efficient and can be more useful in the online teaching learning process. So effective assessment tips and tricks. So how you can have good assessment. Prepare your students for online experience. Until unless they are not prepared, they won't be able to perform well. Frequently review learning outcomes. So make sure that students are reflecting on their own performance and their peers' performance also. It might create some sort of confusion, but in that case, teacher need to play a key role where a teacher is there as a observer, as a mentor, as a guide. A lot of responsibility on the shoulders of the teachers, but it is, because if you are given the position of God, then what next? It is like how God need to just handle everything, a teacher need to handle in the same way. Because in Hindi, it is a saying that Shikshak Bhagwan ke samaan hai, Shikshak Dev Tulya hai. So agar aapko Dev Tulya Pratima di gayi hai, to aapko kaam bhi Dev Tulya hi karna padega. And here we are having, next is present, clear, organized learning materials. So whenever you want a clear-cut assessment, you need to frame your questions in the same way that you expect your clear answers from the students. Build learning community. A student's learning community can help the students to have better outcome. And then this is how a student community can be monitored by the teacher. So teacher can assist the student through that student community also. Let the student take action what they have learned. So make the students be the part of it and make them take actions. Provide them regular feedback and feed forward to the teachers. Next is suggestion for the students. So how students can ensure that they are learning well. Show the students is like, for students, show your credibility. You are not there to just listen, sit back and chit chat about the teacher's performance. You yourself is responsible for your learning. So here, not only teachers are responsible for your learning, you yourself is also responsible for your learning. Make sure you know your credibility. Make sure you yourself is aware about your learning. Next thing is be a researcher. Don't stick to the classroom content. Be a researcher, do research, and make sure you are capable enough to satisfy your learning needs. Feed forward as welcoming step. It means feed forward should be given by the students to the teachers. Rely on quality and authentic resources. Like whenever you are submitting your projects, whenever you are submitting your assessment task, like you are responding in the quizzes, then make sure whatever content you have learned should be from authentic resources and having quality resources. And next is keep a record of your work and time management, because at this time students are there at home and they are not concerned about the time management of their own. So they are most of the time they are wasting their own time, and ultimately it is going to affect their own performance. So keep a record of your work, what you have learned today, and how much you need to learn for one day, and how you are expecting yourself for the next few months or in next coming appointment opportunity. So make sure you are making yourself capable enough to perform in that way. Coordinate with coordination with teachers, peers, and administration. It is the responsibility of learners and as well as teachers, administration, because everyone, each and everyone is interdependent. So in this learning process, teacher is not only the responsible person, administration is not only the responsible person, but everyone is having their own duties and own capabilities and to perform in the classroom setting. So here, coordinate, it is responsibility of the learners to coordinate with the teachers, peers, and administrators to get a better learning outcome. Actively participate at every stage of learning. Learn to tackle technological errors. So here, when teachers are dealing with the technological things, so what we are expected, because at every end, isolated learner is there. So you need to learn to tackle technological errors by your own also. Next is suggestions for the teachers. So firstly, I think I have given too much instructions for the teachers, but also some suggestions for the teachers are also there. So create an interactive environment. Don't hesitate to try a new method and new approach, because it is the most common thing found in the teachers. They hesitate to adopt new things because they are teaching from past 7 years or more than 10 years. So they might be having a sort of fixed view regarding teaching. So just break down your shell and just move out and have a good try to the new methods and approaches. Prepare a list of your own observations about students and eradicating your own teaching flaws, and take initiative to deal with the difficulties, flaws, and errors. Be prepared and deliver short, effective, structured content. Here, teachers are not expected to have like 2 hours or 3 hours video. Just give them a short, precise, like a lecture of 10 to 15 minutes, but make sure that it is crisp and having quality content, which can cater the needs, and rest, leave them to the learners, and they are also there as a show their credibility and show they are active in the class. So it is going from the both the parts, from the learners, from the teachers. So it is a learning session, learning part from both teachers and students. Organize every required stuff priorly and deliver the best content you can give. So thank you so much. This is how we can have a good interactive classroom session. And I hope I'm going from like interdisciplinary concept, because I myself belong to educational background, and I think audience are from mixed background, having students from engineering, from pharmaceuticals, teachers, and respected juries and people from various backgrounds. So thank you so much. I tried my interdisciplinary concept about teaching and learning of online this process. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam. Very excellent representation by you. I'm thankful to
Dr.
you.
Dr. Prasanna, and you can stop screen share.
Oh, thank you so much.
Yeah. Your lecture is very energetic and very meaningful for all of us. Thank you, madam. Thank you. Madam Preeti, madam, continue.
Thank you, Dr. Prasanna. It's a really an remarkable session. Really, in the toughest time, each and everyone should adopt the change with a new paradigm, which is very much required. And whatever the situation, it's a vice versa. We are also a learner, and students are also a learner. So learning process is continuous. It's not one way. It's always be a two way. Newton's third law is there. Every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. So we go with that process. Even for the teacher, teacher needs to integrate with the technology seamlessly into the curriculum, instead of viewing it's an odd and throughout, and by giving and by the assessment, which is really required, assessment, feedback, which is very much required. And through this deliberation, you have covered all e-learning platforms also. So like classmates, class hooks, you have give the Moodles and everything you have covered in the section, your session, whiteboard, nearboard, and for the quiz you have Padlet, Minecraft, you have suggested. So here we are used to with the Kahoot technology that I learned from the Malaysian lectures, which we have connected. So I learned that Kahoot is also one of the best. And the Google Earth and Google Sphere, really it's a new thing which I heard that in a single platform, you will be connected with all places. So it's really an encouraging one. Moodle, we are used to with this. And during this toughest and lockdown scenario, our National Digital Library of India, it works a lot. So what I observed, day by day, we are getting so many open access libraries and for all the students and the faculties. So it is really beneficial for each and every parts. So it's, I just wanted to say that it's not about the technology. It's about sharing knowledge and information, communicating efficiently, building learning communities, and creating a culture of professionalism in colleges, schools, and your workplace. There are the key responsibilities of all educational leaders. So it is a need of a time which we need to adopt. Every time we have to adopt with the changes that is required for our upgradation. Thank you so much once again. With the Dr. Bhuvan.
If you have any queries, go ahead.
Dr. Prasoon Sharma. Just yes, you can little bit enhance about this global sphere of e-learning in yes. terms of Indian environment. Little bit.
Actually,
so here, say someone says that we have done this course from here and here. Some university say we will not recognize or this and that. A lot of things are here. So can you little bit
enlighten us? In that case, I would like to reflect on your question. It is like actually a quality question, because most of the students are struggling with problems whenever they are going for their interview, that they have shown the e-learning certificate and people are not recognizing it. But in this case, now they are well aware about the fact that things were going in this pandemic situation. So now people are like forced to adopt these e-learning certificates, because at this time, I think you are also going to provide e-certificate. So ultimately, we are having more industries are also getting more adaptive to this situation. And if we are considering this global sphere condition in India, so in institutions like MIT, IIT, they're also providing some e-courses, and those only not for the learning process, not only providing education, but also with that education, they are giving certification. So those will be valid. Earlier, people who are getting education from from distance learning courses, then also people used to question, you have done your degree from a distance course, does it matter? So now it matters a lot. So this is how we are working, and people are having a change in their mindset. Now we are not having a classical and traditional mindset.
Thanks a lot. Thanks.
With this word, I would like to welcome our next resource person. Thank you, Dr. Prasuna. It's such a nice session. And with this word, I would like to welcome Dr. Shubham Dubey. He is a computer science lecturer, University of Debrecen, Hungary. And I just, Dr. Sunil, can you please find where he is? I think we didn't connect him.
No, he's there. With us.
I just make him a co-host. By which name he is connected? Shubham.
Shubham Dubey. He's here. Please, Shubham
sir. I'm making him co-host.
No, no, he is unmuted now.
No, no, no. We need to make him co-host.
Yeah, you make co-host. Okay. But Shubham sir, are you able to?
Yes. I think yeah. I'm audible to everyone, and my video is also shared with everyone, right?
Yes.
Yeah, you are audible.
Welcome, welcome, Dr. Shubham Dubey.
Thank you.
His topic of deliberation is solution of implementation issues when shifting classroom to online teaching. So, which is required, and I think I also learned so many things from this your deliberation. So, I welcome you once again, and I just want you can brief your achievement yourself so that everyone should know at this platform.
All right. Just some technical issues are there. Just give me one.
You need to screen share.
Am I audible to you, ma'am?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay. All right. So, hello everyone, and good morning from Europe, and good afternoon from India, right?
Yeah, good afternoon, sir.
It was really nice session that we we have gone so far. Like the Dr. Prashun, she has discussed a lot of things, and it was just like.
Bit louder because.
Hello.
Yes,
ma'am. So. As far as you have discussed, Dr. Prashun has discussed, so I'm syncing with that same thing, and I'm forwarding some the opinions that we've got from Professor, the first speaker that we have, our chief patron. So Professor Saraf, right? So first of all, thanks to your institute, thanks to everyone for giving me this opportunity. And as far as my achievement and other things are to be concerned, I am working here in University of Debrecen as a researcher and as a facilitator as well. I'm joint researcher at University of Budapest, Eötvös Loránd University, Hungary, and also I'm a researcher at University of Vienna, Austria. So today I'm going to talk about what are the technical difficulties. I've discussed about some case studies that I've those are my experiences that I've got when I was adopting e-learning when I was teaching in India. So I'll discuss those things, and I'll also discuss that why I've shifted myself. Actually, I was a software developer, right? In my college days, I got 4 to 5 companies, Infosys, TCS, and a lot of the creamy and dreamy options that we have in India. But I have shifted myself in e-learning, and the story, long story is there. So that I have framed in the case of, in the form of a case study. So first of all, I'm going to share my screen with you all. And I think it's visible for everyone.
Yes, sir.
All right. So my topic, the topic that we had, actually I've discussed this different topic that is quite different. No, we can't say that it's much and more different, but I'm just I adopted some blended learning technologies and the things that I am working correctly on. So the topic that I'm going to discuss today is about the problems that we are facing in e-learning, and what are the alternates of e-learning, and what are the basic, we can say, solutions when we talk about the Indian perspective, right? Because in India, e-learning is not that much advanced, right? So agenda that we will discuss is I'll start from a case study, then a cross-cutting concern, we will discuss about why we should go for e-learning and why it is mandatory for us. And Prashun told that it's a global need. And if we want to survive as a learner, it's really important to adopt these things, right? And difficulties and solutions. And then we will go for ARCS model. This is a model that is used for motivate learners when it comes to e-learning. And I will discuss about the research that I did when I was implementing and extending ARCS model for e-learning for a project of University of Debrecen. And then we will discuss about Kirkpatrick model. In the last slides, Professor Prasun was discussing about how to assess the learning and how to assess the teaching. So that will be synced with this thing. And then we'll go about virtual learning platforms, what we have options for pharmacy students, for engineering students, what are the technical issues that we face and what are the solutions that we have worldwide, right? And then we'll go for blended learning. So teaching, basically, I did my master from Delhi University, and I, after that, I got placement, 4 to 5 companies, and I've joined one company, but I was not enjoying there because I wanted to be a researcher and I wanted to be a professor. So I've shifted myself. At that time, I wrote a book. It was based on, in 2017, right? It was based on how to improve learners' engagement in e-learning and how to, improve the quality of content, right? The book was already published in 2017. And then what I did, I have shifted myself in e-learning, not exactly, pedagogy. It was e-learning. So I started my first project in 2018. And from there, I've started my PhD. Right now, it's almost done here in my university. But meanwhile, I have I've done 4 to 5 projects in e-learning. I was a developer in Moodle community. So we'll discuss some other opportunities that we have in Moodle for teacher that usually teacher, they can't find because of restrictions or they are not aware of those things, right? So teaching for me, it's Professor Saraf told that we should behave as a teacher and we should respect teacher when it comes to teaching and learning. And because this is the only profession that creates a lot of other professions, almost all the professions, right? And for me, I did several jobs, being a researcher, I conducted research, I monitor research, I worked in software firm, and I worked as data analyst, and I was doing a lot of, work in data science as well. But what I found, this is my personal opinion, I think most of you would be agree, or some of your thought process may vary, that this is the hardest job guys to do, right? And what I found, actually, we do these things, not for money or perks. We just do it because we want, right? We passionately, we want to be a teacher because in India, we are not getting that much. Right. So when it comes to e-learning, what we should focus on is asking what sort of education and learning our community support is, how we decide what sort of community we become. For it is through education and learning that we engage with our future colleagues, friends, and supporters. So when we are entering the classroom, every time we should, this is what I do. When I'm joining a project based on e-learning, always I remember this thing because I don't think that this is I'm doing for couple of days or couple of weeks. Always what I think that this work may lead the century, right? May lead this decade, right? So this is really basic fundamental thing that motivates us as a teacher, and our motivation is very crucial when it comes to e-learning or we can say a face off kind of learning platforms, or we can say educational setups. So the case study that I was talking about in 2018, when I started these things like teaching there in an institute in India, I don't like to discuss about that institution, but yeah. So initially when I started, it was I was teaching there a subject that was Unix, an operating system. And another subject, it was based on programming, that was this SQL, right? Advanced SQL. So I faced a lot of hectic, comments, a lot of hectic things that were, playing just hurdles, And I was really, at that time, what I was doing, I was trying to move a stone, which was really difficult to move on, right? But I thought, if I learn from here, or if I'm doing something and I'm facing a problem, so ultimately what I will get at the end, I'll get that, yeah, if I want to be success, I'll get, yeah, this is the way we shouldn't be follow when we are adopting e-learning, right? In 2018. So in level zero, when I've started implementing the things in Moodle, so what I did, I talked to the head of our department that I want to teach with e-learning platform Moodle. At that time I was working as a like part-time worker in Moodle Society as a developer as well, like software developer, right? So what I told, why not to start from our institute? So what I did, I started implementing the things there. Some of my peers, some of my colleagues, they told, yeah, it's good, and even we will help you out. So we've started. So in ground level, that is L0, what I found, you can see in the screen, your right side thing is teachers, we can say their views, their reflection and their actions. And in the left side, the students' reflection and students' behavior that I've noticed when I was implementing these things. So in ground level, like in level zero, what I found, teachers told no, straight no. No means no, it's not possible. Because they were in their comfort zone. They didn't want to come out from the comfort zone to adopt it, though they know it was very easy, right? Once they have implemented, so many of them told, yes, it is really easy, and it's very, convince our students as far as their learning is to be concerned, and also as far as their, feedback and their skills is to be concerned, and for their own perspectives as well. So in the beginning, they told completely no, but students, for them, it was fun. They have started, I really got surprised results. They have adopted, most of them have adopted, and they told, yes, sir, we would like to be the part of that. And we would like to learn through e-learning platforms, because for them, the thing was that they no need to come to the college, right? So they can go for GT, right? In India, we say GT. So they can go for GT, they can roam here and there. Even they can do their gym work at the same time, they can learn the lecture as well. So this is what I tried at that time. And in the very basic level, when this is like level zero, we face a lot of problems. In level one, one level up when we went, what we found, some of students told that, everything is okay, but we are not happy with exams, right? Because the exam was based on quiz and it was multiple choice questions. So for them, I restricted their access based on their other, we can say they can't open any other portal, they can't open any other browser while they are doing the exam. And the questions were random for each and every student. So for them, it was really difficult, right? Because there was no scope of cheating, everything was fair. So for them, it was it's really difficult for us. So some of them become shown their very panic, opinion. But I told, I know this is very difficult for you, but then it's come for disruption, right? Then we are going to do something really innovative. For that, somewhat we need to compromise, right? So later they have adopted the things well. But again, if we'll discuss about teachers in L1, most of them told that we want training. We give training them, and what they told, even after training, I think we are not comfortable with that, right? So some of them, because they do not want, they did not want to change their mindset, or we can say their premeditated thought process towards technology acceptance. And that is the problem when we talk about Indian, pedagogy, or we can say Indian teaching. Though some of teachers are really doing good, but few days before one of project in which I was working, they told to conduct a workshop in Moodle or we can say any of online learning platforms which are free. So the problem was that they told, everything is okay, but we don't have access of internet, or we don't have computer, and in mobile or in smartphone, we can't do that. So a lot of problems were there. I can say some of problems were very genuine, but somewhat what I found, the premeditation was really one of, killer thing that we faced at that time when we were implementing. When we went one level up, L2, most of students were satisfied with timelines, because the timeline, question paper, exams were the main issues with students. But when it comes for the teachers, those who got training in level one, they were very comfortable and they tried. They show we found their result. We have observed that, yes, they're really trying their best, but still we can say almost 60% of population, student teachers population, were not comfortable with that. The reason was that either they were from a background where, from which background, with which it was really difficult to cater or we can say to merge the things with e-learning platforms, right? Like your Moodle, okay. Or we can say most of them have, we are facing problem because it was a management course for some of them. So it was like for management, we can't deal with this because we need to explain a lot of things and we need to show some practical work. We need to show some case studies for that. We need to deliver lecture. So I like, though I motivated them because as a computer science teacher, if I can do, I can conduct my laboratory online. I can do all these things online. So why can't you? But yes, the problem was there. In level three, 50% teachers told yes, it's okay. And they really shown the result, right? But remaining like the 50%, for them, it was still like a rocket science kind of work, right? But for students, at the end, what I found, the main problem was issues with exam and content. Apart from that, everything was going very smooth for them. So at the end, what I assessed that for student, it was positive, but for a teacher's perspective, it was negative feedback that I got from there. And in the next slide, I will show you that what were the opinions that I found at that time when I was implementing this thing, right? So these were their feedbacks. Like most of them told that, stop it. This is really something that we are not going to do. This is really difficult for us. It's not possible in Indian education society. It's not possible for us because we don't have that much technical support. So the first thing that came was to stop it. Second thing that made like huge impact was nonsense idea. If we have traditional teaching approach, we have books, we have libraries, we have these things, we have resources, we have laboratories, we have computers in our weekends institution, then why we are doing this nonsense thing, right? So most of them were saying either it's like stop it, nonsense, or it's just like, some of them told yes for some days, like I have motivation for some days and some days. So according to them, it's like we can say for 1 week or 2 week we'll do, and after that his motivation will drop, and after that nothing is going to happen. So since I was facilitating as a lecturer, I was not permanent staff over there. So like for them, maybe the reason was that he's not that much experience, or he's just tech guy. So he's just like, he's having enthusiasm and he's implementing the things, but for us it is difficult, or that I've discussed their premeditation, or they are not very much familiar. They were not very much familiar with technical things, and they were getting salary if they have facility to teach offline, and there is no any rule from government, then why to go for online teaching, and some like course and content requirement as well. So a lot of things were playing the role. Some other feedback, like student will suffer. According to them, a student will suffer, and I think it needs some more facilities. Yes, of course, facilities. And most of them told that we want a re-revision, a revision of a revision. I mean, frequent faculty development programs or workshops, how to use these platforms. So this kind of like opinions were there, right? At that time when I started, and some of them like, I can't do, right? So and why to do it? If we have those like, we can say previously developed system, which were really doing good. So all in all, it was like 50-50 for me. Yes, I got disappointed because that was my first project initiated by myself only. And like, for me, it was not a failure because I learned a lot from there. And I thought that this problem, like issues of exam and content, I thought, why not to take it as a PhD, right? So what I did, I like got a short-term PhD offer from University of Debrecen as a scholar. So I got acceptance. I prepared a proposal based on modeling of e-learning. So I got acceptance and I started my work and research work over here, right? So what I found, why, like what are the cross-cutting concerns when it comes for e-learning? So from my opinion, and what is the current need of this society nowadays and for coming decades? First thing is the digitization. Everything is going to be digitized, or everything is, like most of things are already digitized, even in India as well, right? So if the digitization is happening each and every domain, of course, we can't ignore education. So this is the first reason and first cross-cutting concern. Second concern, that is the bitter truth, we can say, education is a business and we have to deal of skills. So ultimately, if we are not having skills, how to deal in e-learning platform, how to work in, we can say, how to adopt these things, how to work with ICT educational setup. So yes, of course, we will be kept out from the market. Ultimately, education is also a market, a reputed market, where we deal with skills, we deal with technologies. We're not dealing with technologies for like, we can say delivering the content or these things earlier, but since like we can say half of decades and for the coming years, we will be dealing with these things. So at the end, this is our demand and this is our first demand. If we want to be sustained in the market as a teacher, you have to accept these things. Because in here in Europe, like in India, we have several portals for, we can say, registering for a course, for the admission and these things. But in Europe, we have each and everything based on e-learning. In whole Europe, we have one system that is known as Neptune. And in Neptune, we deal with, we can say, admission, we can say registration for course registration, for lab, for teaching, for attendance, for your feedback, for your complaints, for your forum, each and everything we deal that we deal with is in your, the platform is known as Neptune. So ultimately here in Europe, and what we say, like we are like in India, we are like 5 or 10 years lagging with Europe. So in coming 5 or 10 years, we will be having these things in India. And at that time, if we are not going to adopt these things, we can say innovation and in e-learning, so of course there will be a problem, right? So the better thing is that why can't accept from now? If we have facilities, if we have scope of learning, because the experienced teachers, I'm not talking about the youth, the experienced teachers, those are having their age like 40 or 40 plus, and they are facilitating in some institutions. If you people won't accept this thing, the problem will be what? If your competitor will come, if he will be having higher skills or more skills than you in technical things, of course, your era is going to end, right? And you will be dropped. So the problem is that acceptance, the problem is that the truth, and the problem is that what we really want to do and where we really want to, we see us as the instructor in coming 5 or 10 years in this developing era. The third thing we can't ignore is your demand of personalized learning. Because nowadays, like because of COVID-19, most of people are doing a lot of work in Coursera, edX, and several institutes like MIT, Oxford, even our Aotea, my university, University of Debrecen, University of Vienna, they are providing a lot of courses which are like free of cost, right? And you are earning certificate, right? And most of you have found, if you are following a course in edX or Coursera, they give some tasks to us, right, to complete. And once we complete those tasks, we get some rewards. We get some, we can say, if we are not getting reward as badge or as certificate, what we found is, we found a lot of things based on practicalities, right? So sometimes we want personalization as a learner and as a teacher also, for a special kind of learner that Dr. Prashun has discussed, that sometimes we have different categories of learners, like who are not able to cater with e-learning platforms, who are not able to cater with, or we can say, simulate with technology-enabled learning. So in those situations, we want personalized teaching and learning system. So when it comes to personalization, of course, we need to deal with this e-learning platform, or we can say blended learning platform, because there we have customization, we can say, facilities, right? Then, of course, this lifelong learning thing, of course, when we are having these things like e-learning, so content is available there everywhere. And in coming, we can say, world or coming days, we need to deal with several skills. We need to, we are supposed to equipped with these skills, which are like, which are there in think tank, and some of them are in the market, are in higher demand, right? So when it comes to lifelong learning, our content should be there in e-learning platforms. And for putting the content in e-learning platforms, we are supposed to be enabled. We are supposed to provide content, quality content, which should be in high demand for coming days as well, to earn revenue and to earn, we can say, fame as well, and make it more viral. So for the sake of virality, for earning money and for being sustained in the market, this is really important to accept these things and to be motivated for lifelong learning. Because frankly speaking, here in Europe, if you will talk to a person who is like 60 or 65, even they people are learning several things, right? Because they want to be sustained in the market, right? European Union is giving money for everyone in like who are residing here. But at some point of time, we can't ignore that like the things are getting expensive. So we can't ignore with these things when it comes for learning, right? And the fifth one is fittest survival. Of course, the Darwin's rule. This e-learning supported system or ecosystem is itself a world. And according to Darwin's theory, if we want to be sustained, we have to fight. We have to be fighter and we have to win. So if these are the threats that we have to adopt the things, we are supposed to learn the things, we are supposed to be technically enabled, we are supposed to be technically equipped, we have to fight. So these are five cross-cutting concerns and these are forcing us to adopt e-learning facilities, e-learning platforms. So the basic, we can say the fundamental difficulty is when we start, adopting e-learning platforms are these. We can say the first one is your multitasking. Yes, when we start a course and we start teaching, so when, like, if we are not properly planned, we face the problem of multitasking, that we need to deal with the students' problems, we need to provide feedback, we need to provide proper guidance to them, we need to create content, we need to upload the content, we need to make content qualitative, we need to merge, we can say sync the content from the previous class and next class. So a lot of things we need to deal with in, at one time stamp. And at that time, it really becomes important to adopt multitasking behavior. So either you can do multitasking or you can plan your content before starting your course. So you should have a proper deadlines and you can make those deadlines hard and soft on the basis of your work and workload. And at that, we can say, when you are reaching to the that red deadline, you have to iterate the things frequently. I think from the second last slide or like fourth or fifth last slide in Prashun's presentation, we found that there was a step of iteration. So that iteration is really important. We have to, filter our content. We have to reassess it every time. We have to revise it. So while during the class as well, sometimes it becomes important when you're, executing a course at that point of time, you have to make it very, iterative. And of course, learning and teaching is an iterative process. We can't ignore that, right? So if either you have to be multitasking person, agent, or you have to plan the things properly before your class, before your course. Second thing that, assignment issues. When we start the process and we give assignment to our students, there are a lot of problems that, hello, sir, when can I submit this? What is the deadline with this? What we are supposed to submit? What are the things we are supposed to submit? What are the technical things we need to submit in a project when it comes to laboratory and practical classes, right? And so a lot of questions are there. So for that, you can note these things like in a page, you can create a proper FAQ page in your content or in your e-learning platform, wherever you have your course, so that each and every, you no need to reply to each and every student for this, little or smaller problem that everyone as a learner face. And those are like very important because if they want submit assignment on time, maybe they will lose their grade. So in that situation, it becomes really important to be proper, executor of these things, right? And for that, the best practice is to have an FAQ space. Then, of course, the deadlines, set a reminder for each and every student 1 week before when you have your submission date. So each and every student will get notified about that thing. And if you're doing that, ultimately, you will get your assignment on time. So there won't be problem with grades. There won't be problem with learning. There won't be problem with course execution and the simulation of the courses and linking the previous skills or previous things with your current course, right? Then the content diversion and advertisement and pop-ups. sometimes we give them references. This is the problem when I've noticed this problem when I was doing a research in motivation, the factors that can affect learners' motivation when it comes to e-learning platform. So the problem was that the content diversion and pop-ups, when they are following several e-learning platforms, there are a lot of pop-ups problems and they deal with. So at that time, it becomes really hectic. And if you get a sudden pop-up that you're interested with, of course you will go to that pop-up, right? So this is like important thing we should focus on, and we should we can say cater with. We should have a proper plan. We should have a proper quality content without reference diversion and without pop-up issues. Then justifying grades. Sometimes we are not like students have problem with that. Sir, I did this thing the way you told, and still I didn't get that much mark. So what is important at that time? We should be able to justify them grades, like what was the reason that you get this much grade, you got this much grade, and where are the scopes of improvement. So this is a good practice to adopt so that a student will become motivated and they won't drop your course. Then learning management systems, a proper learning management system should be adopted, because sometimes what we do, like in India, we have Moodle or we have other platforms. Here we have several, we can say, platforms. Those are like customizable, and those are sponsored by universities in Europe. But when it comes to learning management systems, sometimes if we are executing I'm a teacher of a pharmacy course. So we can't say that every time Moodle is perfect for pharmacy students. Or if I'm a computer sciences teacher, sometimes Moodle is not perfect for them. Sometimes Edmodo is not comfortable for them. Sometimes Azixa is not comfortable for them. So we have to select correct platform for correct course. This CC is very important. Correct platform for correct course. And that motivates you as well. And that keeps students motivated as well, right? So the further difficulties that we have is the isolation issue. Sometimes when we deal with these things, students face the problem of isolation. And in isolation, it is like we can say very important topic, because as a teacher, you feel sometimes very isolated, because sometimes when we are shifting ourselves from classroom to online teaching, what happens actually, as a facilitator, we are not used to this kind of environment where we don't have students in front of us. So what we can do at that point of time, the proper treatment of isolation is very important. So we can be in touch with emails. We can be in touch with several forums. We can in touch with video blogs. So that keeps them motivated. And as a teacher, that improves your teaching as well. So here, isolation of both entities, both the stakeholders, teachers and students, both should be treated properly when it comes to get the more and more outcomes of e-learning platforms. Apart from that, there should be some, scheduled regular check-ins with students via emails or chat that I was talking about, with forums, emails, and chats. And time management. When they are facilitating in e-learning with three learning platforms, the time is really important, because what happens, like when you start teaching, so many students drop their motivation and they drop your course, right? So time management is very important. And sometimes we get some situation which are really surprising for us. So how to act accordingly when it comes to surprising situations? So the time management should be proper when it comes to execution of proper way of your e-learning course, right? And also when it comes planning, if we have already done proper planning of our course, our content, this becomes very easy to manage your time properly. Then urgency. Sometimes we, like while teaching, we meet with situation where we need to deal with urgent situations. Like we want some urgent feedback. We want some urgent assessment. We want some urgent submissions. In that situation, what we can say, what we can do is we can prioritize our work, and we can talk to our students that these are the things you are supposed to do earlier in by this time, but we are changing the schedule, so it should be like this now. Then quality teaching resources. Of course, our resources should be qualitative so that student will not suffer with the problem of content. And also, it should be managed properly and it should be relevant. Sometimes we are teaching something which is really nonsense for students. I face this problem. Trust me, this situation is very, we can say, panic for students, because they do not want to your class. they do not want to be the part of this platform or that particular course for that day, but they have to because they need to show their attendance, right? So in these situations, your content should be qualitative, your content should be relevant. That will be giving, some treat for them for their professional work that will get in their future as a learner or as a professional as well, right? Also, verified and precise content should be there. It shouldn't be like more, because sometimes what happens when we talk about content, sometimes the content is not that much verified and it's not, so sometimes we just refer Wikipedia, and which is not a good content to cite on, right? So what we can do at that time, we can hire some third party resource, so third party verified content, like some universities content, some journals content, some books, those are high demand in reputed universities, and those contents should be verified. So at that point of time, when we have verified content, students get motivated for their work. And also you feel that, yes, you also as a teacher are learning a lot, and you are meeting the situation where you can innovate. You can create knowledge from knowledge. And that is very important. Being a teacher, being a student, this is not only a responsibility to learn and to solve our problem and to get a job. But being a teacher, the main thing is create a knowledge from the existing knowledge. Just imagine the situation. What if Stephen Hawking wouldn't have invented this thing, the theory of relativity, the theory of dark matter. So these are the new knowledge. Those are derived from the theory of motion that was given by Newton, the theory of relativity by Einstein. So ultimately, as a teacher, as a professor, and as a learner, the second most important motive, like after learning, the second most important motive should be creation of the knowledge from the knowledge, right? Then improper communication, sometimes it happens, like a student messages you in the night. So if you really want to be effective in your teaching, you have to reply in the midnight. And this is the truth. And I have executed this plan, and trust me, I got feedback from the institute and from our university. Like this year, I adopted these things, my whole teaching in e-learning platforms, and I was awarded as the best teacher award in our university. So the reason was that I even replied in the night 2 or 3 as well. So you have to be fair, you have to be honest, and you have to be careful with each and every minor to minor problem of students, because your small or your single response can keep him motivated, can keep him linked with your course. So sometimes we face some technical difficulties as well. So what are the technical difficulties, like issues of internet issues related to our technology acceptance, issues related to our content access, issues related to content delivery. So in that situation, it becomes very important to create a blog, or we can create FAQs for technical issues. So every time no need to talk to each and every student. If someone is facing a problem, he can go to your user manual. If you'll go to my website, you will search my name is Shubham Dubey in Google, and if you'll go to teaching page, you'll find how to use my own e-learning platform that I'm teaching there. There are some links. Maybe these links are disabled for Indian students, because apart from our university students, because if you log in with our university platform, our university EduRoam, then only you will get the access. But you should have a proper user manual so that you will, you won't be busy. You no need to be multitasking while teaching or delivering the content. So for that, we can use a help desk system, online help desk system through email, chat, and forums, or you can create a community of students so that the students can solve the problem of their peers, and that will be effective teaching and learning strategy. Also, assessment is very important. Whether your students have reliable access of technology, or they have actual they are getting the things that you are delivering or you want to deliver. Sometimes what happens, we are delivering something else, but due to technological, or we can say due to this virtual, synchronization, sometimes they won't get those things that you actually want to send, that you actually want to communicate. So this is also important. So in that situation, you can assess your teaching through formative assessment schemes, like class throughput. You can conduct a class throughput that how many students have passed a particular barrier or threshold of your, that day's teaching, and how many students have passed or they understood the topics that you taught at that day. So these things are very effective, though these things are very small and pinpointed, but when you are teaching, these things really matters a lot. Because if you are assessing your daily teaching, if you are assessing the daily learning of students, ultimately you are meeting their problems that they have faced at that day, or we can say that they are facing daily. So you can develop and you can trace your learning and develop a model that what you should do and what you should not when it comes to the proper execution of teaching. Then a proper model should be developed in order to hire LMS, that which LMS should be used for which type of learning and which type of course, right? This is very important thing. I have already emphasized these things in the previous slides. Next, make your students familiar with the online and classroom via video blogs. So when you are going to execute a course, before that course, like you got a subject that you will be teaching these students in this semester and this subject. So you can make a video and you can upload that video in YouTube by saying that, yes, I'm going to teach this thing. We will do these things. These are the outcomes of the course that I'm expecting from you people. And this will be the objective of whole course that you can expect from this course and from me. And you can use this kind of strategy to adopt the learning and how to follow the course, what will be the practical things and where we need to emphasize a lot, where we need to focus on a lot. So this is how you can create a video blog. So students can explore those things before starting the course, and keep them motivated themselves. And also they feel very much connected to your crux that you're going to teach. So you can make a video blog as well, right? And create an online resource library for your content and your, practical assignments for your, video blogs, for resources, audio, video, textual, which kind of resources you have. So ultimately you can keep motivated them and yourself as well. So ultimately what is it? This is the feedback, right? Sometimes you cannot force them to submit feedback through a feedback form. If you are getting higher and higher engagement in your e-learning system or in your course, ultimately this is the feedback that you are getting, right? So sometimes this intrinsic feedback will be used for you to trace your teaching thing, right? So the next thing is that motivation. And this is the biggest issue that we face when it comes to e-learning platform, right? So this time for student, like how much time they're spending should be proper, and what you can do you have 1 hour's course, so you can tell them, okay, today we are going to finish in 45 minutes. So in 15 minutes, they can refresh themselves, or they can ask some questions, or we can say, they can ask you that what are the things we can cater with for, or we can sync with, or we can learn for syncing with the next topic that we have in the next class. Or you can, we can drop some witty question. You can give a case study or scenario that, hey student, we are going to discuss this thing, but what if we will do this and this one, and we won't get this solution. So this kind of questions like what if, or why, what? So this kind of questions keep them motivated, and you can utilize those 15 or of those 20 minutes. For giving them something which is out of their syllabus, their book, right? Or you can, motivate them for doing something new, which is innovative. Because bachelor and master students, they do not focus in research. Most of the time we found this. So those 15 to 40 minutes, you can do that thing. And if you're doing that, ultimately they can keep connect, they feel connected with you, with your course, and they can find innovative ideas to research, right? So these are the basic and fundamental things when it comes to improve the motivation, right? and you can use your time. Also, there should be a measurable and quantifiable outcomes. This point is really important because when it comes to objective achievement and how much you really got and how much you have planned, so ultimately the quantification of assessment, sometimes it becomes difficult because we cannot measure the objectives in any on the basis of their quantity. And when it comes, we can say quasi experimental, or we can say quasi education system. So at that time, what we can do, we can assess our learning on the daily basis. We can assess our teaching on the daily basis, and we can set objectives daily. So how much or what are the portions of those objectives you have achieved or your class have achieved? So on the basis of that, you can we can say assess our learning and teaching, and this assessment will be quantifiable, or we can say quantity based assessment. So this also, this thing, like, you know, keep you linked with how to assess your learning, and you can trace your things. Next thing is that a means of accountability. Sometime accountability, of course, that we have already discussed in the previous slides, that this needs to be onto or your share platform so that everyone else can see. So accountability is also important. We have already discussed, I think, in previous slides. So, of course, sometimes we meet a situation, we give some scenario to students, or we give some assignment to students. And what we want is, if someone did that, we can give them reward, or we can gamble. Yes, if you will do that, I'll give you this much grade. And please keep your promise. If you are making a promise that, yes, if you will do this assignment, I will give you one grade more, or I'll give you 5 marks extra, give them. We are not giving from our pocket, right? So we can do this. And that keeps them motivated. And that keeps them, we can say, greedy as well, right? To join your course and to learn things. Next thing is that create a virtual reward. Like, we can say, create some badges. We can create some certificates. So if we are given an assignment and that was really difficult to solve, so the students who have solved them, like first 5 students, those who have submitted that assignment, we can give them that badge or certificates, and that keeps them motivated for the next assignment. And they will do it innovatively, and they will try to make it as efficient as possible, because ultimately they need to, they try to keep it as early as possible. They try to keep it as soon as possible with innovative ways. So ultimately, you are indirectly doing research. You are giving some research question, and you are getting feedbacks as well in the form of innovative ideas. So this is really one of the things that is important. You can send them GIFs, images, and a lot of, we can say, emojis to them when they are submitting the assignment. So ultimately, that keeps them connected with you. So the next thing that we are going to discuss is how to assess the learner's motivation. So this is the model by which can assess learner's motivation when it comes to e-learning platform. So this model, this is ARCS model, is having 4 fundamental things: attention, relevance, confidence, and satisfaction. And when it comes to attention, so ultimately we need to deal with 3 things: the perceptual arousal, inquiry arousal, and variability. If we are following these things, 3 things, ultimately we are keeping them attentive, and we are getting their attention. So how we can get their perceptual arousal? So for that, we can drop a question related to the next topic. If there is a question related to the next topic, a student in the next class, when he'll come, they will prepare themselves for that class, right? So this is how we can keep their attention on, right? Second thing is your inquiry arousal. So for the inquiry arousal, we can drop a question. Hey students, we have this scenario, we have this case, what if I will do this? So ultimately they will think about it, and they will disrupt new ideas. So ultimately, indirectly, they are going for the researchers as well. Or if you have a class of 40 students, at least 1 or 2 will give you some ideas or innovative ideas. Those can be published as a work or as an article for them and for you as well. So these are indirect outcomes of your research, of your teaching, right? And you are creating knowledge from knowledge. So we can drop this kind of question that can keep students motivated, and we can get their inquiry result. when it comes to variability, of course, if we will vary our content on the basis of the media, like if we are providing audio content, we are providing video content, we are providing textual content, we are providing some other kind of content like codes, blogs. So ultimately, that keeps them connected and them motivated, because we have categories of content, varieties of content. And of course, everyone likes varieties, right? Even in our daily life. So that keeps them motivated. Second thing is relevance, right? So how this course is relevant for them. So realize this thing for them, that how important it is for you now and how important it is for you for the future. And when it comes to their professional work, how important it is for them for their professional, and how important it is for when, like, if they are going for the research, if they are going for the interviews, if they are going for to write a paper. So these things ultimately keeps them motivated and keep them connected, because for them it will be an important thing, right? So the goal orientation should be there, and this goal orientation can be of two types: class objective and course objective. I told you, try to assess your each and every class. If you have 50 minutes class, 40 minutes just each, and in like last 10 minutes, you can conduct a short quiz, the topics that you taught at that day. And this is how you can assess your daily teaching and daily learning, right? So this becomes very important when we are teaching in e-learning platforms, because we are not connected face-to-face with our students, right? The next one is motive matching. So in motive matching, we can say this needs like a formative assessment, right? So like the motive that we have for a particular day or for a particular class, we can conduct some formative assessment on the basis of topics. Like we taught three topics. So how many students are able to pass the question or solve the questions related to those three topics? So this is our topics, we can say throughput, or our teaching throughput at that particular class. Next one is familiarity. Our students are supposed to be familiar with the content and familiar with like what they are going to do and what they will get. So relevance is also considering the familiarity with the content, with the future scope and the motive that will be, we can say that they are going to achieve at the end of the course, right? Next thing is the confidence. So the measurement is confidence is something very virtual, right? And it is not quantitative things. It is like qualitative. So you can observe them randomly, right? And some point of time we have learning requirement, like for some students or like if we are doing some vocational course, we are teaching a vocational course. So what happens, each and every students, they have their customized learning requirement. So whether we are catering those requirements or not. So this is how we can assess their confidence. If someone's learning requirement is not fulfilling at that time, he'll drop the course, right? Even you can see if it is short course, if it's your 1 hour lecture also, if people are quitting, if people are losing their motivation, they will quit. And nothing is wrong with them and nothing is wrong with you as well, because what you are delivering is not useful for them. They think that, or you are delivering the thing that you want to deliver in your whole course, because this course is linked with the current, the next course. So at that time, some restrictions also we have from the point of institution and universities, right? Next thing is the success opportunity. Whether they are aware with the success opportunities, like if they will finish their course, what are the success opportunities, what they will get in their course, or what we will get at the end of course, whether is it useful for them for their professional work, their further works, or when they are going to the market, will it be useful or not? That is also important for them. So these are the things by which we can assess their confidence. Of course, personal control as well. Like what are the difficulty levels that they are facing and how much we are solving their difficulties. If we have a lot of difficulties, ultimately there are two things. Either they are really facing a lot of difficulties and they are doing hard work, or they are not doing anything and they are like doing nothing and it's not at all. Like your course is not going good. So there are two things. We have to be careful with these things. Hence, I'm emphasizing that your formative and daily class assessment is very, very important when it comes to e-learning platform. Then satisfaction. For the satisfaction, we have three fundamental things. First is intrinsic reinforcement on the basis of that their problems, the progress that they did, and on the basis of the difficulty that they are facing, we can assess their intrinsic reinforcement. And for the extrinsic, we can provide them certificate.
We can provide them rewards. We can provide them, we can say industrial visit or virtual visit of industries or like a setup where they're going to work in after the end of their course. So these things keeps them motivated when it comes to e-learning platforms. So next is the other major concerns. Those are playing like crucial role when it comes to e-learning adoption. So here we have a time consuming resource management process. As you can see, first is that plan before the execution of the course. And also there should be a proper algorithm that I told you. There should be a proper algorithm and video blog when you are going to start your course so that you can deal with students' problem. And you no need to be panic when it comes, like when their queries are coming, right? The second thing is that online training is boring sometimes. And of course it is, whether it is like 1 hour's course and whether it is like 1 week course or whether it is 1 month's course. Online training is really boring. I am a teacher. I am on like e-learning researchers. Sometimes I really feel that it's really boring. What's the shit is going on? Because they are not interested in their course. So the thing is that first you have to assess which kind of audience you have. A second thing is that what is their demand? What are their demand and what they want actually and how much it is useful for them? So this thing should be properly planned before execution of the course. And in e-learning, planning is very important. Planning is much and more important than in e-learning than your offline learning platform setups, right? Students encounter technical difficulties sometimes. And when it comes to technical difficulties, we need to cope up with them. We need to keep them motivated because this is the biggest factor along with motivation that students drop their courses. And this technical factor can be sometimes very shitty, even shitless. Like, sir, my internet is not working. I don't have Wi-Fi, right? Sir, YouTube is is asking me to pay. Like in Europe, you can't use YouTube freely, right? We have to pay here. So you can't, sir, I can't use it because I don't have money, right? I have spent my whole money that I have for my pocket money for this month. So sometime you need to find the alternatives of these things as well. So be prepared so that you can cater with some surprising situations, right? And that keeps them, we can say, motivated because if you're doing putting your efforts for them, ultimately they will feel connected with you. And sometimes, you know, at the end of the course or in between the course, they can feel that emotionally they are connected with you. And trust me, when it comes in India or Asian countries, emotions are very important even in teaching, right? So we have to be aware with these things. And last but not the least, this time consuming resource management process. So the planning should be for the course content as well. Because I already told in the previous slides that reference diversion and pop-ups, these are the major factors. And sometimes, like if you are, suppose a situation, you are teaching a course and students have joined your course, but you have gave them some references where they are getting some pop-ups which are really not relevant to their content and which are really out of the world, right? So what, who will be responsible for this thing? So we have to be careful with these little things as well. Right? Because if the system will be hacked, of course you are responsible because the course is yours. I don't know what are the conditions in Asia, but here in Europe, if anything will happen in your platform, like the links that you give, you and only you are responsible. So provide them content, provide them web pages where the pages are not saving their cookies. They're not saving their passwords. There is no scope of intruders. Right? These things are important. And here we have a model, Kirkpatrick model. This model talks about how to assess learning when it comes to e-learning platform. So in that situation, what we can do is we have four levels of measuring our teaching. In first level, we talks about engagement, we talks about relevance, and we talks about customer satisfaction. Engagement we can assess through, if it is e-learning platform like in Moodle, we can assess users engagement on the basis of this log files, right? For every user in Moodle, you can see that how much time that particular user has spent, right? So this is how we can assess their engagement. When it comes to relevance, of course, that I told you whether their work and your teaching, they both are relevant or not for like each of you, like your teaching, whether it is relevant to him or to them and his approach his assignment submission process and his work that he's doing is relevant to your teaching or not. Next is your customer satisfaction. So in customer satisfaction, like student satisfaction, you can assess it on the basis of their, we can say, feedback, on the basis of their problem-solving skills and how much problems they are firing on you, how much difficulties they are facing. On the basis of that, we can assess their reaction, the first thing of Kirkpatrick model. The second thing is learning, right? And when it comes to learning, we have basically three fundamental things: confidence, skills, and knowledge. These things should be assessed properly. Attitude and commitment, these are, we can say, qualitative things. And we can like randomly observe these things when we are teaching, right? So knowledge and skills can be assessed through daily teaching and at the end of summative assessment as well. But when it comes to skills, sometimes we need to conduct some practical activities. And practical activities are what actually, when it comes an online course, these practical things can be done through virtual apps that I'm going to discuss in next slide for that. Like I picked some of the virtual labs, those are used for students, for pharmacy and for engineering and like medical and non-medical students in the coming slides we have. So we should have proper execution plan, we should have proper execution strategies, and we should have proper assessment strategies as well for assessing learning, skills, and their knowledge, right? Third thing, which talks about their behavior things, behavioral development. And in this behavioral development, we have reinforcements, reward, and encouragement. Encourage, that is what actually hunger, whether they have the hunger for the coming things or not. When it comes to reward, I have already discussed that we can assess them and they can assess us on the basis of how much we are solving their problem and how much objective they are thinking that they have achieved of the courses, right? And the fourth thing, we have leading indicators like and desired outcomes. So this comes in formative and summative assessment. I was talking about in the coming slides, in the previous slides, about throughput. Throughput is what actually, how many topics you taught, and out of those topics, how many topics students think that they understood. This is throughput of that day teaching. When it comes for your their learning, so like we have a quiz of 80 topics are there, or 90 topics are there in the whole course. So for a particular day, like you have 8 classes, so you have 10 for each and every class. So in these topics, we can drop one question from each of the topic. And when we are varying the number of these things, like number of questions, so how many questions a particular student has solved in one class or in particular class. So we can assess our teaching and learning at the same time, like on the basis of instincts, right? Here we have some virtual laboratories for pharmacy and chemistry students, because I got to know through Sunil sir that we'll be having pharmacy students, right? So here we have some, we can say, innovative virtual labs by which we can conduct some of experiments. The first one is BERT. And actually, this is sponsored by an organization that is known as Merck. So this is very much customizable, we can say, a lab. We can visit it. I think I can show you this. But I think I need to share my screen through this, right? So just 1 minute. Is it my screen visible to?
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay, so these are the platforms by which you can customize your content. So this is a Merck sponsored lab. Here in this lab, you can conduct this thing with your mobile app also, because they have their mobile app. So for Apple and for Android, they have several like platforms by which you can do this thing. So once you will visit these things, you will start the lab, right? And here you have several things. Like for chemical industry, we have environment monitoring section, for quality control, for research development. And if you'll go any of these, which chemicals you need to add. Like if you'll visit here with this sign, you can see the chemicals like acids. And for customization of other equipments and other things. We have properly designed, we can say, simulation. So you can visit these things, and from where we can conduct our lab through online platforms, right? So this is, like we can say, very innovative idea I found. Here we have other, like that is sponsored by MHRD India. That is known as, I think this is for engineering students also. This is known as Virtual Lab in India. This is sponsored by Ministry of Human Resource Development in India. So you can visit this. I'll share at the end of this thing, my website to administrators. So you can like go through with this on this. Next is our virtual chemistry. This is sponsored by USA, government of USA. And here we can go, we can visit this lab and we can conduct our experiment. Also, we can go through the quiz. We have some short abbreviations on particular issues, particular experiments. So these things are like quite customizable. Like this, the Merck one was customizable. And it's quite a, we can say it's semi-virtual. It seems that you are there in the laboratory. Right, internally, initially you need to pay some fees for the course and for conducting the experiment, but it's not compulsory for each and every institution because they have member institutions as well. So I don't know whether your institute is connected and they have collaboration with them or not, but we have several opportunities and several plans by which we can connect with them. Then next one is Labster. Here again, we have quite customizable and catalog based lab by which we can conduct, and is sponsored by US, Denmark, and Swiss government, and Indonesia as well. Next one is Simform, and this is sponsored by US. We have free demo of each and every experiment. We have free trial for short duration. I think that was for 14 or 15 days. I'm not sure. I visited just like when I was preparing this thing. But this is giving customizability for us, right? So we can visit this thing, this laboratory as well. We have Lab for You. I think this is very popular in India because I was checking that how many, like what are the engagement of in Lab for You, and what I found, the highest engagement was from India only, right, in Lab for You. So I think this is very well known in India. So you can go and visit with this lab, virtual lab as well. Next one is Pocket Science Lab. This is ultimately a platform which is like for Android users. And it's, I don't know whether it is available for Apple users as well or not, but for Android, I'm not sure this was available. So you can download it in your mobile phone and you can customize your laboratory. Then Praxi Labs, similar facility they are giving. VLab, the same that I was talking about virtual lab, but this is for engineering students. And this is sponsored by several IITs that we have in India, IIMs and NITs. Then InSimu, of course, this is giving a simulator. And I found interesting thing that even for the pilot course, like in my university, we have a course for professional pilots. So like when we teach them pilot thing. So for the first semester students, we use this laboratory for online simulation. And with the basis of that, even you can feel that you are driving the plane live, right? So these are some innovative research laboratories that I found and that can be useful for you. Okay, but as Professor Saraf told that there is an alternate of e-learning, and that is known as blended learning. This is the last segment of my work, my presentation, and this is the thing in which I am working now. This is my project in which I'm working in my university, and this for the same topic, for the same thing I got the fellowship from University of Vienna. And trust me, this is much more acceptable for students and for the teachers, because this is giving you the flexibility of both the things, right? For the learning and for the teaching, like at the same time. And also, if you are having problems with internet, if you are having problems with times management, so since this is giving you the customizability, customization, so at the end of the day, a student can join you even in the night, and he can go through your video blog and he can study that thing, and he can drop a question, you can solve the query in the morning. So because this customizability and further, we have some benefits in blended learning that enforcing us to adopt this thing instead of directly going for e-learning, because directly from classroom to online teaching, when we are shifting, like transiting from classroom to online, directly going for e-learning is really a bad idea. So first we can go for blended, then we can go for we can shift for e-learning. But I don't think in coming 10 years in India, I don't think that the e-learning will be in high, because in US, like in Europe, when I got the data and I have analyzed, they have already started these things in the first decade of this century. And what happened, so far they did not achieve higher excellence and higher, we can say, engagement in e-learning, even like after two decades. So India, we are starting these things there. So in coming 10 years, I don't think that, in coming 5 years, I don't think that India will be fully equipped with e-learning facilities. So we can adopt blended learning, especially in Asian countries, right? So why we are going to use it and what is it actually? It is a blending of your offline and online, both kind of teaching, and we can use it whenever we need, and we can customize it on the basis of our purpose, our objectives, and our aims of the course. So yes, of course, it seems quite, you know, like fascinating. So we have a better recommendation for this thing. And why it is so, this is the reason of why of that part. We have these things, these five fundamental, we can say, concerns, fundamental facilities and supports, those are enforcing us. Instead of going for e-learning, first go to blended learning. And the first thing I'll start from, flexibility. It is giving us the flexibility in representing content. You can deliver it through offline, you can deliver it online, you can plan your things, right? Flexibility of content is stocking. You can stock your content whether you want to facilitate through online, through offline. If you want to facilitate through offline, just do one thing, give them book, tell them to study, and at the end of that course, you can like discuss with them their problem and difficulties. And when it is online, you are free enough to discuss that thing through online. So flexibility of content delivering is also is like good we can say aspect of blended learning. The flexibility of customizability, of course, I told. Then effectiveness, trust me, as I told you, the report according to US Education Department, what I found that they have executed this thing from 2010 to 2020, and they found that this like blended learning is far better than e-learning and face-to-face learning, right? So it is quite effective than remaining one. So first just go for blended learning, then go for e-learning. Efficiency, of course, it is efficient than e-learning and directly like offline. We can't say that offline learning, because in India, frankly speaking, students are used to and teachers are also used to. So sometimes they won't feel comfortable. But once they adopt it, right, they will feel it. That yes, there is something, we are doing something better, and we are having flexibility. At the same time, you can go through several, like while the teacher is teaching, you can visit through several content through online platforms. So there are a lot of like ups and downs, but if we'll focus on ups, we can find a lot of things which are making it like, you know, quite fascinating. Then personalization of customization, because each and every student, sometimes they need customization of the content and personalization, because I do not want to study that topic because that is not important for me, right? Or if we are dealing some professionals, right? We are conducting some workshop at that point of time, like HR department, they people do not want to get the technical things. So we can personalize this thing on the basis of blended educational setup, right? And then extended reach as well, because since we are implementing through both face-to-face and online, so it becomes very we can say extensive, and the variety can be achieved higher and higher in this, right? We have basically 15 models of blended learning. Those are the derivation of these five fundamental models. So I'm just discussing these five fundamental models, but even you can make your own model, and that will be a new model, right? But for developing a model in blended learning, it is very important that it must be recognized by 4 to 5 institutions, right? So first, develop a pattern, develop an algorithm of teaching, execute it 4 to 5 institutions. You should have proper execution plan, you should have proper results, and if you get success, yes, that is your model, and you can get the patent of it, right? So we'll start from flex blended learning model. This flexible blended learning model gives us facility that students can rotate from several platforms. These platforms can be our science laboratory, this can be our briefing room, this can be our online virtual room, this can be our online live blogs or live classes, this can be our social areas where we can connect. Suppose we want, we can say, coffee discussion with students. We can come, we can tell them, hey guys, come, we are going for the coffee today and we will have some fun and we'll discuss these things. And this is how we can customize it, right? So ultimately, this is giving us the flexibility of delivering mode, right? So this is the first model, a flexibility learning model. And execution of this model is not that much easy when it comes for the execution and implementation. Second is the station rotation model. A student can rotate through several stations. This station can be the same things, but here we have several, we have a defined algorithm, but here there is no defined algorithm. So like a proper algorithm should be designed that when we need social education, like social meetup, when we need virtual meetup, for which topic we need laboratory, for which topic we need classroom face-to-face like delivery. So these things we need to plan. This is what I'm saying. When we want to execute these things, first we need to have a proper plan, whether it is e-learning or if it is blended learning. Then third one is face-to-face driver model. In face-to-face driver model of blended learning, what we do, most of the part of this model is basically our offline, right? And online driver model is just opposite. Most of the part is online and less the part is your offline. And the fifth one is enriched virtual learning model. This is basically the fifth mode of teaching in which we have online teaching and we have offline. Like student will discuss the things through online platform when they are at their home and they can discuss the things. We can teach them like with face-to-face mode when they are there in the class, right? So in this virtual learning model is giving us the collaboration of 50-50 contribution of both the things, right? But here in face-to-face driver model, we have higher portion of face-to-face, lesser portion of online, and in online, we have just the vice versa of it. Then blended learning has given us some, like it has unlocked some, or we can say concerns and some facilities which were not available earlier. Because of blended learning, these things came in contrast and we are doing good in blended learning because of these. So first thing is the customized. Of course, this is the best feature in blended learning that we can customize our content. And from the beginning of my presentation till the last slide, I'm discussing that the customizable content, because I have implemented these things here, like in two classes, and I found customization is the first demand of teacher and students both, and personalization as well. Then second thing that was unlocked by blended learning is that from being given to finding or creating. So like what they have from, they can create new thing. So ultimately what I was talking in the first, in the earlier, that knowledge has its own property that it should be created from the previous existing knowledge.
Exactly.
So this should be created. This is how we can, yes ma'am. So this is how we can create the things, create the knowledge, and we can create them, we can say, with the basis of innovation, and we can do something big that I was talking about, something we do. We don't know that whether we will get tomorrow Nobel, right? So sometimes these little things make significant contribution, right? So this thing is important, right? Then the next one is that from one size fits all to tailoring. Yes, like earlier we have fixed things, right? But here it's like, it can be vast, depends on your e-learning platform, that how many students you can connect and how many of them you can cope up with. So these functionalities and these enabled, we can say, attributes are making blended learning more famous than the e-learning. Next one is from listening to doing. Of course, because at the same time they are doing it their own way at their own end. Like in classroom, either we can teach or they can do. In the laboratory also, most of the time, either they will do, when they're stuck, they will come to us. Then we will solve their problem or they will be doing their work. But in blended learning, we can do at the same time when we are learning. So learning by doing and lively doing this thing is, we can say, one of the biggest achievement that we have in blended learning. And last is your from copying notes to presenting your own work for others. So these are some fundamental things that we have in our this kind of setup. So that's all. If you have any question, you can ask, or else you can drop your question. You can visit my website, you can find my email, or you can drop the question in my email, shubhamdubey, 1312@gmail.com. It's not written here. So that's it from my end.
So you can need to stop the sharing.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Shubham Dubey ji.
Thank you, sir. Thank
your you so this blended learning is something new and it's a good idea.
Yeah. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you so much.
It's a nice session, nice presentation.
One thing I just wanted to say that it's really you have just figured out all the facts and figures that really e-learning is changing because with this COVID-19 pandemic, the utmost and topmost priority is that where quality of education reaches the most inaccessible corner driven by our digital learning. And definitely this e-learning platform is changing the world and we will see new models. New technologies, designs that emerges out. So let's drop that E. We have to drop that E and come up with the learning, which is very much required. And well said about your the teachers, you have covered up the point. Teacher really needs to integrate the technology, which is need of a time. You said whatever the time it seems to be, I just pick up the phone of my student. See, definitely this culture we need to adopt. Because we are not like to teach them every time. Teachers are for guide. Teacher, it needs to guide the student. Teacher is for giving the path to the student. Whatever the time, it's everyone should know their limits and they must be follow that. But still, there will be some emergencies and whatever the ways. So it is required very much. And teaching in the internet age means we must teach us and our student for the tomorrow. That is very much required. With this word, I just wanted to really highly appreciate it by your deliberation and Dr. Prasoon's deliberation. And it's just we have connected. Please accept the token of appreciation from our society. And it's really heart touching.
Thank you so much.
What message you want to give to all the participants?
From my suggestion, if you will ask my opinion, the first thing is that be adaptive, be prepared for any emergency situation, even when there is not emergency, because we don't know what the morning will be, the next morning will be, right? So being a teacher and being a student, the first thing is that adopt the things and do not hesitate to learn, right? No one is insulting you, right? Do not hesitate to learn. There is no age for learning. Just accept the life learning path. And second and very important thing is that, trust me, since last 5 years or coming hundreds of years, that we can say the definition of learning and teaching will be changed totally. You have to go for e-learning, otherwise you will be kept out of the market. This is the bitter truth and we have to accept it.
It's really a bitter truth because either you need to adopt this learning platform and you will be competent with the digital, digital world. This is very much required because being equipping teacher with the technology will definitely automatically enhance their work and needs. They needs to improve their self because once you are presenting in a digital platform, everything goes, viral. So for that, you need to be practicing, improving ourselves. So this is also one of the good concepts.
For coming 2 years, actually, a lot of things is going on. Like a lot of projects are there in US and here in Europe. Like people are working long. Maybe in coming 2 or 3 years, some we can say virtual reality will be coming in teaching as well and learning as well. So ultimately, that will be quite live classes. But so far, we don't have that much facility. So this is a buffer time, right? Then we can learn how to adopt, how to be technically improved, so that we can deal with and we can cope up with all these things. When we'll be having those, innovations. So these are my final words. Just accept the things, be technically strong. And if you have any questions and if you are implementing these things, if you're doing innovation, you have problems, just ping me anytime. I'll revert you within 24/7. I will be available. So
that's gratitude has required to each and everyone.
So I will be available. And this is what I can do for you as a learner, because I always think that I'm not a teacher. I'm not like that much strong. We can say a well-known body. I'm just a learner and I want to be a learner. So I'm a learner. You all are a learner. We all are learners. So we can contribute each other. We can collaborate together and we can do something which has not been done and that will be useful for the coming society as well. So that's it from my point of view. And thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much, sir. And thanks for your institute. Like, you people are really doing something like that is necessary and which we are supposed to do for creating that. I'm saying that creating the knowledge from knowledge. And also, the audience was really nice. Thanks to everyone.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Now I would like to present a token of remembrance to Dr. Prasanna Sharma. Might be she is with us. I invite her to say a few words.
Thank you so much. And as it rightly mentioned by Mr. Shubham Dubey, it is like opportunity. Really wanted to fit the situation. Then you to the present like theory of evolution, theory of fittest will survive, and everything actually is the right time to explain that how the things are changing and how we need to prepare ourselves for the changes. And this is how we can make ourselves better learner and better future citizens of this global era of knowledge. So we ourselves make ourselves as a part of the knowledge society and knowledge community. And this is the digital time where we need to build a global knowledge community and flourish with together. As Vasudeva Kutumbakam, we need to perform together.
Exactly. With this spirit, we need to come up. We need to come up with all this condition. And each and everyone should have this spirit inside. Then only you can be success. You will get in a path of a success, which is very much required. With this word, I would like to move forward for a word of thanks ceremony. And for this, I would like to welcome Dr. Bhuvan Chandra, Principal, Ideal Institute of Technology, Wada, Palghar, Maharashtra. I welcome, sir.
On behalf of Ideal Foundation, I thanks firstly to Professor Preeti Tagde ji, who has given this opportunity to our organization.
And I'm always
I would like to thank Shubham Dubey ji. That he has given his experience and he has explained a lot what happens and what is the really e-learning, what difficulties we face, what difficulties students face there. And I also thanks Dr. Prasun Sharma. She has given a lot of new things in terms of she has related something to pharmacy also, and this is the time of digitalization. In coming time, if you don't have your efficacy towards different platforms, whether it will be e-learning or something others. We are lucky that we have all such infrastructure and we have all such good brains in terms of computer, because we have seen a time in 84-85 that even our teachers are not allowed to touch the computers when we are having the COBOL programs. To find one mistake, we have to take out around 30 or 40 pages. So now the students are lucky as they are living in this time, and this COVID-19 has given us a new thinking, new imagination that how the students can learn at home. So thanks once again to Professor Tagde ji, Dr. Dubey ji, and Dr. Sharma ji.
One thing I also add.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bhuvan Chandra ji. Now I would like to welcome Dr. Sunil Singh, Principal, Ideal Institute of Pharmacy, Palghar, Wada.
Thank you, madam. Thank you. Personally, I would highly thankful to Dr. Manmohan Singh. You don't know about the Dr. Manmohan Singh. He is a friend of Dr. Subham. I just told Manmohan Singh, please, I want to.
Every successful story, there is a man behind.
Yeah. So I just told him that we want to conduct international webinar, so suggested some name. So he immediately suggested the Dr. Subham told me you just a message to him, he will reply you. Okay, that was after the sudden I have message to Dr. Subham now. Dr. Subham is available, then medium from the Dr. Subham, Dr. Prasunna is available. So that is the connectivity of the each other. So I'm highly thankful to first Dr. Manmohan Singh, then Dr. Subham, then Prasunna sir, then you, Prizal Society also, you are available for the all necessary things. And our Ideal Foundation, our chairman sir, and our respected director sir, and all of the participants from the our students, our college, and outsiders. So I'm highly thankful to all of you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sunil. And this, education learning process will not stop in any ways through our platform. We'll be continue learning. And last but not the least, I just wanted to say that. Hello. I just yes, wanted to say that the way of teaching is changing and updating every day. The tradition and the old paradigm of education is not demanding anything now. So we have to equip with the classroom with new technology. It's after post COVID-19 scenario, I'm telling. It has its own advantage. And with this learning platform and this, virtual way, we are come up with best practical approaches also in near future. We are working on advanced learning and advanced teaching programs. So those who are really, interested to attend the advanced training programs. So from day after tomorrow, we have a planned session. So any of you can mail on us a registered mail ID so that we can invite them also, because we cannot break ourselves, we cannot break our education system, because many of people in this platform has writing. What about the practical approach? Yeah, so for practical approach, we are working. So we have completed one module, now we are moving towards the second module. So it's really one. And I really thanks to, Ideal Foundation, Honorable Mr. Abhishek Jain, sir, who is always with us. Busy somewhere, so he didn't join, but anyways, his blessings are always with us. I would like to thanks Dr. Bhuvan Chandra ji for well-maintained setups with all the dignified researchers from every field. I welcome and thanks Dr. Sunil Singh. I thanks Dr. Shubham Dubey for nice deliberation. I would like to thanks Dr. Prasun Sharma
for her
deliberation. So thanks with this concluding words. I just say bye-bye. We'll fill
milling. Bye-bye. Keep learning.
Okay, bye.
Keep learning and sharing.
Bye-bye.
Hanji.
Just one line.
We
want your physical presence in our organization after some time.
Singh was already visited our campus, sir, one time.
you have annual function of your students over there in February, before lockdown. So I was there for a guest lecturer. So I met Mr. Abhishek Jain also over there. So we'll think, we'll plan something, big event over there. No issue. Thanks for your concern. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.